what it is.
Getting set for kickoff in about 8 minutes. Coach Charlie Weiss and the Irish dropped the first two home games this year. Now they're winners of three straight and ranked sixth in the nation. That's the highest ranking for them in 3 years. And welcome to our New York studio. We'll send you out to South Bend in just a moment. It's Notre Dame's final home game of the year and therefore the last game at Notre Dame Stadium for the Fighting Irish seniors.
We try to win. I think that's how you honor them. I mean, there'd be nothing worse than to honor a group of guys with a loss. I mean, so I think that's the whole point is respect your opponent, know your opponent, know their strengths, know their weaknesses, but play for your seniors.
Well, meanwhile, a quick NFL note. Still no word on the Terrell Owens situation. Yesterday, a 14-hour arbitration hearing was held in Philadelphia to determine whether the Eagles can continue to suspend the wide receiver. A decision is expected by Tuesday. Time now for this week's Lincoln Financial Look to the Future, and for that, we go to the developing BCS picture. Last year, of course, USC routed Oklahoma in the Orange Bowl to win the national championship. This year, if SC and Texas win out, they will almost certainly meet in the Rose Bowl to decide the national title. Now, if Notre Dame wins its final two games, they will be BCS eligible, and word is the Fiesta Bowl very interested in the Irish. Lincoln Financial. Hello, future. Well, we'll see you at halftime. Until then, enjoy the game, Notre Dame and Syracuse.
This has been the Lincoln Financial NBC Sports Report.
Notre Dame Stadium filled for the final time this season as Notre Dame hosts Syracuse, saying goodbye to nine scholarship seniors playing their final home game, and here come the Irish. Charlie Weiss, as is his custom, the final man out of the tunnel as the Irish take the field for the final time this season here at Notre Dame Stadium. They'll wind up the season at Stanford next week, and the Irish in Charlie Weiss's first season seemingly on their way to a BCS bowl if they can win out. Tom Hammond and Pat Hayden here for the final time this season. It has been a remarkable season for the Irish and for Coach Weiss, who's made all the right moves on the field and off the field as well, and most notable is the improvement in the offense of the Irish, ranked 10th in the nation right now. You see that dramatic improvement. And Pat Hayden, it has been a pretty impressive season.
Well, he's been a brilliant play caller, but you know, his whole staff in Charlotte did really just change the attitude, I think, first of this team, and this team really believed in themselves and a great deal of confidence. And what has he done? Well, this is a team, remember, that at the beginning of the season, they weren't ranked in anybody's top 25. Well, they're currently ranked 6th in the country. They have a quarterback who is on fire. Brady Quinn has set 15 passing records. We'll set them all before he's finished. He's played as well as anybody in the country. And defensively, they've forced 7 red zone turnovers. Zivakowski's been particularly good. And then what Charlie Weiss said was this summer, Tom, hey, you can turn the team around fastest on special teams. The special teams have really helped them win a couple of games. And as you said, they could be a BCS team and maybe win 10 games this year.
Of course, a different story in Syracuse. They have a first-year head coach with an NFL background as well, Greg Robinson. But the Orangemen have won only one game. They really have struggled on offense, one of the most anemic offenses in all of college football, taking the field now. You saw Coach Robinson go by, and there are the players from the Orangemen getting a few rounds of booze from the Notre Dame partisans here at the stadium. So Greg Robinson's first season has not been as everyone had hoped in Syracuse, but the defense has been pretty tough.
You're right, and they can do it a couple of different ways. Ryan McCass off the corner has 7 sacks, a former high school sprinter, 10-5, 100 meters in high school at 230 pounds. Then up the middle, Kelvin Smith, the middle linebacker, kind of, you know, clogs it up in the middle. But I think the best player on this defense is Anthony Smith, having really an All-American year and leading the country in interceptions with 6, has blocked 3 punts, had 2 interceptions against Brady Quinn a couple of years ago. So the offense is anemic. If Syracuse is going to have any chance, the defense is going to have to carry him today.
All right, it's Syracuse and Notre Dame, the final home game of the season for the Irish. And we'll be back with the opening kick, the Orangemen and the Irish, right after these messages from your local NBC station. passing yards, 27 touchdowns, 5 interceptions. Our Adidas starting lineups for the Irish on offense. Walker, the tailback, Schwab, the fullback. Stovall and Samarja, the wide receivers. Fasano, the tight end. And the blockers, Harris, Santucci, Sullivan, Stevenson, and Lavore.
Every one of those offensive players you just mentioned have had their best years this year, Tom. Every single one of them. Offensive linemen, backs, receivers, and of course, Brady Quinn.
Hand off is to Darius Walker. And Walker gets to the 30-yard line. Stopped by Tommy Harris, one of the starting linebackers from the Orange. But as we check the Syracuse starting defensive alignment with Weish, Thorner, Drame, and Lacasse up front. The linebackers, Pruitt, Smith, who's the leading tackler, and Tommy Harris, who made that stop. And in the secondary, Jackson, Davis, Smith, and Gregory. And as Pat mentioned earlier, Anthony Smith tied for the national lead in interceptions with 6.
He's also blocked 3 punts this year.
Quinn to the air for the first time in traffic and nearly intercepted, intended for Samarja.
Kelvin Smith almost picked it off. Tom, the middle linebacker, we showed him at the very top of the show, a guy that Greg Robinson moved from outside. He's number 8 right here. Just dipped right in front of that slant route.
Yeah, Pruitt was there too.
Greg Robinson moved Kelvin Smith from the outside to middle linebacker, said, hey, he's found his spot.
So no huddle for the Irish as they face a third down. Blitz comes from the Orange defense. And Quinn winds up, throws a high ball, caught by Matt Shelton, but just short of the first down, tackled by Taylor Jackson, who prevented the first down yardage. So the senior, fifth-year senior from Collierville, Tennessee, gets his first catch of the game.
Yeah, really a good defensive series because, you know, it was good coverage because there wasn't really much of a rush on Brady Quinn. So good coverage downfield once by the middle linebacker, and that time by Tanar Jackson, the corner.
Syracuse does have a good pass defense, one of the best in college football. D.J. Fitzpatrick, his final game, will kick it to Bruce Williams.
Bruce Williams is the deep man for Syracuse.
Patrick's punt, wobbling, short. Williams takes it and immediately slips down just across the Orangeman 35-yard line. No return, but the punt only covered 31 yards. Zibikowski covered Williams after he fell.
Set up first and 10.
Well, the Syracuse offense is a 2-quarterback system, kind of like Tennessee from a few weeks ago. Neither quarterback has really been able to take charge, but Harry Patterson gets the start today after earlier in the week it appeared Joe Fields would start. But Patterson under center to open the game for the Orangemen today.
See how big he is, almost 250 pounds.
Hand off to the tailback Rhodes, who turns the corner. And gets a couple of yards before he's knocked out of bounds by Corey Mays. Let's take a look at our Adidas starting lineups now for the Syracuse offense. Rhodes is their leading ground gainer, the tailback, who is 10th all-time in rushing at Syracuse. McDonald, the fullback, Lane Moss, and Kovaleski. Paulke, Madison, Alton, Franklin, and Ojanaka. I had to give that to me first time.
You could have done it first time.
Pass from Patterson. Short hops Tim Lane. Incomplete.
That's been the problem with the offense. A lot of passes like that this season for the Orange.
Third and 8.
And the defense for Notre Dame. Abby, Mary, Laws, Landry, and Talley. Hoyt, Mays, and Crum. Hoyt and Mays playing their final home game. With Wooden in Duqueway, Zibikowski, and Richardson.
Much improved secondary.
Thought to have been a weakness when the season started, and has not been that. And seemingly getting better every week.
Bill Lewis, the coach, has done a great job with those guys this year.
From the shotgun, Patterson is going to scramble ahead with a lot of room to run. Asks for a block. Gets one from Kovaleski. And out of bounds on a big gain. The quarterback scramble. Perry Patterson for 29 yards.
Boy, you know, when you get that man-for-man coverage down the field, which Notre Dame had that time, your quarterback can step up into the pocket. And if you break the first, you know, line of defense, you have a lot of room to run. All the defensive backs really had their backs turned to the quarterback, and that allowed Perry Patterson, all 6'4", 249 pounds of them, to gallop. One of the big plays for the Orange this season.
Patterson has has scored 3 rushing touchdowns for Syracuse this season.
One-on-one matchup down at the bottom with Damian Rhodes on the linebacker.
To the 30-yard line, Ciara.
You know, that's one thing. There's a new formation for Syracuse. They shift to Damian Rhodes, ordinarily their best runner, out to a wide receiver. And Brandon Hoyt had him out really wide one-on-one. And Damian Rhodes is a very good receiver, second on the team with 22 catches. A formation I would expect him to come back and try to use. It's Hoyt.
Second and 6. Hand off to Rhodes. Nothing there. Hit first by Corey Mays.
We've been saying that a lot the last few weeks. Hit first by Corey Mays. He's played brilliantly, I think, the last 2 weeks in particular. Number 46 right in the middle of your screen. You know, the middle linebackers have to take a lot of punishment, fight through traffic, make plays like that. Had 14 tackles last week and a fumble recovery against Navy. Creates a lot of negative plays. And you see the fumble recoveries and the sacks. And he says, Charlie Weiss would say, what? All day tough.
All day tough. That's the ultimate compliment from Coach Weiss.
Here's that formation again. Rhodes up there.
And Patterson from the shotgun. Throws. Complete to Tim Lane, but I don't think he had enough for the first down. You see the yellow line marking the first down. Short of it, Mike Richardson made sure of that.
That was a nice throw by Perry Patterson and good concentration by Tim Lane. And Patterson only completing 48% of his passes this year. That's completed 58% last year, but a well-covered Tim Lane. But the ball out in front of him, away from the defender, allows him to make the catch.
And so, on fourth down, Coach Robinson elects to go for the field goal attempt from John Barker. Barker's hit 6 of his 9. The walk-on Slargus is 45. This is 42 yards. High snap. The kick. And the official stopping it with a flag before.
Snap. Delay a game. Oh, number 47 on the offense. 5-yard penalty. Remains fourth down.
Yep.
So now what do you do? It would be his longest. He attempts this one from 47.
He's thinking about bringing the offense back on.
Right. Costly penalty against the Orangemen. And that's
the offense.
Sort of been the story of their season. Mistakes, penalties, fumbles, interceptions, missed opportunities. So they're going to go for it now on fourth down and 7.
And you know, they really don't have a go-to guy, you know. That's one of their problems offensively. They don't have that go-to guy in this situation.
Rhodes, the tailback, is up as a wide receiver. Plenty of time. Patterson drills complete. And then dropped, and then dropped. Lane had it right in his belly and then lost it on the way to the ground.
Perfect throw by Perry Patterson, who showed some real nice patience in the pocket. But Tim Lane, a junior from San Diego, California, wide open over the middle. Perfect throw. You know, just didn't catch it with his hands. Bounced off to look like his shoulder pads on the inside and would have easily been the first down.
Syracuse with a missed opportunity. Notre Dame takes over on downs. And we remember him for those Super Bowl teams in Denver.
Oh, there's a 6 Super Bowl rings between these two.
Coach Weiss and Coach Robinson. First down as Walker got barely enough after the measurement. And so from the 40, first down for the Irish. Nothing, nothing, first quarter, second possession for Notre Dame. Quinn's pass was tipped or just way short, but it...
I think what happened was Jeff Samardzija was running one of those option routes, you know, and thought maybe at first he was going to run and out, then decided to watch up there. This is Samardzija, and that's the guy that Brady Quinn is looking at, and it's an option route. I think he thought he was going to break out, and Samardzija decided to break in, and that usually leads to an incompletion, Tom.
Here's the no huddle again. Coach Weiss telling us a couple days ago that they were going to be very aggressive on both sides of the ball to prevent any kind of mental letdown, as they're a big favorite today. Quinn's pass on target to Shelton. And Shelton has a first down inside. inside the 35-yard line of Syracuse. Steve Gregory chases him down after a 26-yard strike.
And Ryan Lacasse, number 94, on the left part of the screen, he almost gets to Brady Quinn. But how many times have we seen this? Brady Quinn steps up, shakes him off, and then delivers a strike to Matt Shelton, senior, 19th catch of the year, holds the Notre Dame record for yards per reception, which he set last year. What was it, 26 yards, I think?
Right.
It was 26 yards per reception a year ago.
He has two already today in his final home appearance. Samarja fights his way inside the 30-yard line. Tackled by Dwayne Davis.
John, we were talking to Jeff Samarja yesterday, and I thought he said something interesting. You asked him, you know, why didn't you make the plays last year? You know, he just said, I had the opportunities, but I didn't, and realized that I was not going to make that mistake. When I got my chance, I was going to make the play.
Yeah, he learned from the experience. You know, he said he had a chance to make some plays, didn't, and so didn't get to play that much, and was determined if he got another chance, he would come through. Has he ever, big time. Quinn's pass leads Shelton out of bounds, incomplete.
You know, this Irish team can kind of beat you a couple different ways, Tom. I think that's the mark of a good football team. And, you know, they can drive it on you, and they've had a lot of long drives. You see those 42 touchdown drives, they've averaged 8 plays over or 67 yards. But look at the bottom. They've had 7 drives of 3 plays or less. So they can grind it out. But when they have to, they can, you know, score quickly. And, you know, as we've seen, they've been incredibly balanced inside the 20-yard line. They can beat you with the pass. They can beat you with the run and on special teams. So this has been a well-deserved number 6 ranking.
It'll mix up in the orange defense, so Syracuse calls a timeout. First timeout comes with 8:46 left in the opening quarter. Notre Dame threatening to break a scoreless tie. Pitch to Walker. Makes a move in the backfield, but can't get free as Calvin Smith had him by the ankle and would not let go. Didn't go for the fake and held on to make the tackle for a loss.
What a great 2 first series Calvin Smith has had at middle linebacker. Number 8 just absolutely reads it, and I think it was 20, Anthony Smith, who kind of blew up 2 blockers in front of Darius Walker. So the Smith brothers absolutely do their job, just as we advertised at the top of the show. Boy.
So on fourth down, Notre Dame will go for it. After a loss of 2, it's fourth down and 6.
This is Samarja and this is Stovall, the 2 guys they've featured in a lot of these plays.
Notre Dame on fourth down. Quinn, under some pressure, gets it complete to Samarja. Bounces off 2 tacklers and claws his way down to the 15-yard line.
You see how strong he is, Tom? We've talked so much about how he catches the ball with his hands. If he waits for this ball to get to his body, I think this is an incompletion. That split second, if he waits too long and doesn't reach out and pull it in, snag it, that's an incompletion. So the strong hands of Jeff Samarja. And Brady Quinn took an absolute shot by one of those defensive ends, James Weish. These 2 defensive ends for Syracuse, awfully fast.
Former high school sprinters.
Look at the red zone attack. 15 rushing and 15 passing to TDs inside the 20.
That one went for 15 yards. Quinn chased and sacked. Cornelius Campbell.
He's not even one of the sprinters, is he?
He got there pretty fast, looked like to me.
He looked like he'd be a third sprinter. The 2 starting defensive ends, you know, ran sub-11 100 meters, and Cornelius Campbell, number 99, just keeps fighting through Dan Santucci to make the play. We were talking to Santucci a couple of weeks ago, and he says about his mom, Sue. He said, she doesn't really watch me and how I play. She says, all that she says, I know I'm supposed to protect the quarterback. And if she sees Brady Quinn go down, she says she worries about my performance, and I'm going to get yelled at by the coaches the next day.
Second down and 16. Quinn with time. Dumps it off to Walker, who settled down in the center of the defense. Got some of it back before Calvin Smith makes another tackle. He's on his way to a big defensive game for the Orange.
You know, if Greg Robinson can ever get this offense in a situation turned around, he thinks he's got some good recruits coming in next year. But defensively, his teams are always going to be well coached and, you know, be at the top of the leaderboards.
And Notre Dame converted on a fourth down earlier on this drive. Now it's third and long, third down and 9. And Quinn is going to have to take a timeout. So Notre Dame spends an early timeout after the Orange had done so earlier. Timeout Notre Dame with that began on the Irish 30-yard line. It's third down and long. No contact made, no flags. Quinn changing the play. Oh, under pressure. Quinn escapes momentarily and then is taken down by Ryan LeCass.
Well, we told you how quick he is off the corner. We talked to him this week and he was flagged down. He was working with Dwight Feeney this summer. He said, hey, that first two steps are the key. And boy, does he have a couple of quick steps. Ran a 10-5, 100 meters in high school.
Face mask against the orange. Dennis Hennigan of the Big East heads the officiating crew today. Another costly mistake.
Yeah.
Face mask on the defense. Penalty is 5 yards from the line of scrimmage. Repeat third down.
It is a 5 yard.
LeCass, you always have to be aware of where he is and how quick is he off the board. He's down here. And this is a guy that came into the game with 7 sacks. Excuse me, he was standing up on the edge. And then, you know, missed him at first, and then got back right up and made a sack on Brady Quinn.
But the face mask penalty puts the ball down at the 10-yard line, just short of the 10-yard line, making it third down.
Didn't look like a face mask.
So on third and four. Play action fake and Quinn to the end zone. Wide open. For the touchdown. So the penalty gives Notre Dame new life, nullifies the sack, and gives Stoneball his 10th touchdown of the season, but a flag is down.
Tripping number 74 on the offense. Penalty is 15 yards from the line of scrimmage. Repeat third down.
So an Irish penalty cost them a touchdown.
Called it on Dan Stevenson, the right guard. Number 74, the man right in here. I don't know about that. I didn't think it was a face mask either, to be perfectly honest. I didn't think that was tripping. But they called on the senior, Dan Stevenson, from Barrington, Illinois. One of six boys in his family. We talked to him yesterday. What do you call his mom? A saint. An absolute saint for his 6 sons.
Always fighting.
Yeah.
He was the youngest of a set of three that took some pounding from his two older brothers. So the sack wiped out by a Syracuse penalty, then a touchdown wiped out by a Notre Dame penalty. We'll do it over. Third down and long. Quinn slipped, but I don't think his knee touched down. And he'll be tackled short of the 20-yard line by Kelvin Smith, his fifth tackle of the first quarter.
I tell you, this defense read that screen so well. Tony Jenkins, number 51, who's playing nose tackle, smelled a rat. He was rushing the passer, and then watch him just stop. Whoops. So, you know, he took that away, and then Brady Quinn realized he had no chance of getting the ball out to the screen. And one more time, Kelvin Smith, you call his name, Tom.
And uses the ball, does Quinn, to keep his knee from touching, or he would have been down there. So, Samarja will hold for Fitzpatrick, 39-yard field goal attempt. Fitzpatrick has hit 9 of 11 field goals this season. And in his final home game, he boots it up and boots it. No good. No good from Fitzpatrick. So the Irish sputtering a bit here in the first quarter. Greg Robinson in the orange come out of it with a scoreless tie.
I was cooking dinner and
NBCSports.com.
Well, he's not a senior, but he gets my vote for MVP. That guy right there, Brady Quinn.
With a lot of heroes for the Irish this season, this turnaround season, but chief amongst them would be Mr. Brady Quinn, who's 5 of 8 to open this game, but still has not been able to put points on the board. And the Orange defense, we told you they were pretty good, and they've played well so far.
Absolutely. They've played particularly well, especially Kelvin Smith.
Syracuse takes over, and on first down, they hand it to Damian Rhodes.
Well, Tom, you talked a little bit about their woes and how anemic they were on offense. This is pretty ugly, actually. There's 117 teams in Division 1A. They're dead last in third down conversions and near the last in all those other categories. At 9 fumbles in one game against Rutgers. So they just, you know, they have 25 total fumbles on the year. So Greg Robinson's got some work to do on offense, but I'm very pleased with the progress of his defense.
Making the switch to the West Coast offense. Patterson has his receiver Moss. Thrown back by Ambrose Wooden, but forward progress will give him a first down at the 35-yard line.
Good protection for Perry Ambrose Patterson, and that allows Rice Moss, number 12, just to run that little button hook. Perfectly timed right in the numbers, right between the 1 and the 2, and an easy catch because it was so well thrown by Patterson.
And so first down for Syracuse. Today's first and 10 line brought to you by Xerox.
Done that at least 3 times, save touchdowns in the next play. The prior two, the other team fumbled. But I'll tell you, Damian Rhodes is a real good perimeter and edge runner. You know, a great offensive block on the right side by Steve Franklin and Quinn Jimakaka. And then allows Damian Rhodes to kind of follow that hole, hit that seam. What a nice career he's had. And a good season this year, in spite of the poor, you know, passing, he still had a nice season running.
And that one added 51 yards to the total. From the Irish 14, first down, Orange. Draw play, Rhodes. Finally collapsed by Corey Mays and Brandon Hoyt.
Brandon Hoyt, one of the leaders on this Irish defense all season, playing his final game, his final home game, I should say, for Notre Dame. See the kind of year he's had, 70 tackles, and look at all the negative plays. 11 tackles for loss and the 4 sacks. Forced a couple fumbles.
We've talked about him extensively. Not only an excellent football player and the leading tackler for the Irish, but a renaissance man.
Yeah. Cole. Fort,
yeah.
Interested in real
entrepreneur.
Estate. Absolutely. Does it all.
And here is another timeout spent by Syracuse. Play clock was down to 4. Patterson raises up and calls the second timeout for the Orange, but they're threatening to break a scoreless tie. It'll be 2nd and 8 Syracuse from the Notre Dame 12 when we come back to the stadium.
Life offers a simple formula for love.
You were mentioning that Quinn and Ndukwe played together in high school at Kauffman High in Dublin, Ohio. Ndukwe, Quinn's favorite target on offense, connecting 48 times for 10 touchdowns their senior year. In fact, Ndukwe recruited first by Notre Dame, and during an unofficial visit, his dad, Stephen, suggested to Coach Tyrone Willingham that he take a look at Brady Quinn. And are Notre Dame fans ever glad? They did.
Give Mr. Ndukwe an assist.
Yeah.
Right? Used to come together down here in 8th grade to Notre Dame Stadium to watch games.
Ball still up the 12-yard line. 3 wide receivers, Chestnut, Moss, and Lane. McDonald out from the fullback spot. Rhodes in the backfield. From the shotgun, quarterback draw, and Notre Dame will have none of it. Not fooled at all, Brandon Hoyt wrapped up Perry Patterson as he tried to get back to the line of scrimmage. In fact, lost a couple.
Well, you know, Brandon Hoyt has been doing this to quarterbacks a lot over the years. Number 39, right in there. And they kind of fought through Damian Rhodes' attempt to block him. And then it was a quarterback draw play the entire way by Perry Patterson, but stopped by Hoyt.
So John Barker will attempt a 31-yard field goal. He's hit 6 of 9, the walk-on kicker. From 31 yards, Barker's kick is up, and it is good. So the Syracuse Orange, over 30-point underdogs to Notre Dame today, take the early lead with 1:55 left in the first quarter. Syracuse scores first. It's only a field goal, but Greg Robinson's crew up 3-0 on the Irish. It's a 3-0 lead on Notre Dame. And Brendan Carney has it teed up to kick off. There are Grimes and Hoard, who are deep for the Irish. David Grimes. And Hoard says, take an knee, stay in the end zone. It will be a touchback. And Notre Dame will take over at the 20 for what has been a frustrating first quarter so far for the Irish. Lewis?
Well, Tom, yeah, after Notre Dame's last offensive series that ended in that missed field goal, Charlie Weiss sat his entire offense down, and he had a talk with him. And here's how it went. He said, look, you guys expect me to start hammering you, but that's not going to happen. I'm not going to do that. Here's what we're going to do. Number one, you got to find your composure. He said, all of you guys are playing too tight. Syracuse, yes, they're getting some good pressure on Quinn, but he says, we'll fix that with some protection adjustments. Finally, he said, I'm not overly concerned. He said, forget about those first two series like they didn't happen, but find your composure now, and the next time you're on the field on offense, put some points on the board. And he walked away. Tom?
All right, we'll see how it works. They have a minute 55 to go in the first quarter, and a first down toss to Walker. Darius Walker breaking tackles, and down the sideline. Walker pushed out of bounds after a big gain on first down, breaking tackles at the line of scrimmage for 38 yards.
Yeah, and his longest run of the year at 38 yards. It was 20 coming to that one. Good block by Mark Lavore, number 73. And then we've talked about it, the kind of the vision. He kind of picked his feet up, right? Trying to get, it was an arm tackle there, but he picked his feet up. But 38 yards later, he's got his team in good position. A good straight arm. You know, they haven't had a lot of big plays in the running game. Actually, you know, prior to that, it was a backup quarterback who had the longest run of the year of 22 yards, but a nice burst by Darius Walker.
Look past Samardzija. Hard to bring down.
Yeah, it's what, 5 yard gain. It should have been nothing.
Tommy Harris finally making the tackle.
Tackle by
remind you that
Harris.
Near the end of today's game, we'll select the Chevrolet players of the game from each team. To honor their determination and outstanding play, Chevrolet will make a $1,000 contribution to each university's general scholarship fund, Chevy and American Revolution.
I know you vote at the end of the game, Tom, but if you're voting for Syracuse right now, wouldn't it be Kelvin Smith, the middle linebacker who's played brilliantly in the first half?
Second down. Play action fake, Quinn with time. And an open receiver, Starbar, in the middle of the field, kept his balance. And then upended by Anthony Smith after a big gain inside the Orange 15-yard line, a 25-yard strike to Stovall.
Yeah, second time we've seen good blocks by Darius Walker, number three. Watch how he steps up and takes the middle linebacker. A great block by Walker that allows Quinn to step up and deliver that ball. And you think about Maurice Stovall. Good square in route here, but 8 TD catches in the last three games prior to today. I mean, it couldn't have been much better the last 3 weeks, right, Tom? And he also threw three key blocks that led to three other Irish touchdowns.
After 3 years as an underachiever, he's become one of the best in the game. Here's Travis Thomas. Oh, hit hard at the 10-yard line by Anthony Smith.
Yeah, and really the speed of Ryan LaCasse, the defensive end as well. Ryan LaCasse has had a pretty good first half, number 94, and Anthony Smith finished him off. Watch number 94 going pitch, trying to get him to stay at home. And he saw the hit, or you heard the hit,
yeah,
by Anthony Smith. He had six career blocks and punts. You mentioned the six interceptions that ties him to the lead in the country and a good tackle.
And the hit by Smith will bring the first quarter to a close. This might raise a few eyebrows around stadiums in the United States when it's announced. First time this season, the Irish have gone without a first quarter score, and they find themselves trailing the big underdog Syracuse Orange. So at the end of the first quarter, it's Syracuse 3 and Notre Dame nothing. We'll return to Notre Dame Stadium for the start of the second quarter right after these messages from your local NBC station. And the Irish with a second and 7 at the Orange 11-yard line. Pitch it to Thomas, using his blockers, and then hit hard and dropped short of the 10-yard line. Short tackle by Dwayne Davis that time from his strong safety spot.
Dwayne Davis the last 2 weeks for the Orange has had 10 tackles in each game. A couple interceptions on the year as well, and played that play at the line of scrimmage very, very well. Born in Jamaica, moved to New York City at the age of 10, took up football, and
Looked pretty doggone well.
Christopher Columbus High School in the Bronx, running back as well as a safety. Although he was injured, only had six games as a senior. Now in his sophomore season at Syracuse. Third down and six. Play clock ticking down. Got it away. Quinn's pass dropped.
Oh, boy, don't see that much.
Samardzija dropped it. So the Irish will attempt a tying field goal.
You know, you said to me during one of the breaks, kind of they look a little flat. You know, this is something we have not seen much from the Irish at all, is a drop pass from Jeff Samardzija.
In fact, I asked Coach Weiss, did he think they had had a game this season in which they had been flat? And he said, no, not really. But today might be the day, as give some credit to Syracuse, too, because their defense especially has been tough. Fitzpatrick, who missed one earlier, will attempt a 28-yard tying field goal. And it's blocked. Steve Gregory.
Steve Gregory right off the corner. You know, this is a guy that Greg Robinson was said was playing phenomenally. He was 25 right down here. Steve Gregory off the corner. And I tell you, that was just, you talk about pass rushers, those first, you know, couple of steps. Steve Gregory got a fantastic jump, and Greg Robinson deserves to be happy.
The Orange ready to play today.
Watch that.
Agree, just blocking the first D.J. Fitzpatrick field goal attempt this season.
It really stuffed the Irish offense.
Damian Rhodes. Wrestled out of bounds by Zbikowski.
Let's go back to the block, Tom. And watch Steve Gregory right off the corner here. And watch how quickly he gets off the ball. Just absolutely, you know, it's like a sprinter. And then afterwards, Anthony Smith.
Who sit there and steal that thing for a touchdown? He has no idea he's calling him. All right? All day. Keep going. That's what he's saying. Together. Good job right there. Great job on that field goal.
All right, Gregory getting some kudos over on the Orange bench. And it's actually the first blocked field goal Notre Dame has given up since 2002 against Navy. Rhodes trapped in the backfield. Makes a cut to the outside. A flag is down as Rhodes is driven out of bounds by Maurice Crum.
Tell you what this Orange team has right now, Tom, is a defensive team that's playing great, and some hope. Some absolute hope that maybe they hang around there and can win this thing.
Well, that was what Coach Weiss was saying. A team that's desperate, have nothing to lose. When you give them a little confidence early in the game, that's your worst nightmare.
You know, I thought that could have been a late flag on Notre Dame because Damian Rhodes was way out of bounds.
There are two penalties on the play. Illegal formation, not enough players on the line of scrimmage on the offense, personal foul on the defense. The penalties will offset. Repeat second down.
Most importantly, Damian Rhodes is still down on the sideline of Notre Dame.
Just now being helped to his feet. After this hit.
He had 6 men on the line of scrimmage. That was the first penalty. Good speed by Damian Rhodes.
So they offset.
Yeah, that's a good call on the late hit.
But the Orange can ill afford to lose their leading rusher, who earlier ripped off a 51-yard run.
You see the 63 yards today, and not only is their leading rusher, he's their number two receiver with 22 catches. A very good screen receiver. Sets up his blockers particularly well. Guy's had a good year when you consider everybody bunched in the line of scrimmage, and he's found a way to run for almost, well, over 800 yards now.
Replaced by Kareem Jones, the redshirt freshman. Second down and five. Lane is in motion and resets. Draw play. Kareem Jones with his first carry. And got only a couple of yards.
Kareem Jones on the carry.
Brian Bydash, the fifth-year senior, playing his final home game. Makes the tackle.
He was tripped up by Bydash.
Imagine, did we expect this kind of weather on November 19th in South Bend?
Well, we didn't expect it yesterday because it was pretty cold yesterday. Thursday, there was snow on the ground in South Bend.
50 degrees today for a team from Syracuse, although they generally play indoors.
Third down and three. Lost it. Wrestling for it. could have been intercepted, but they were both out of bounds. Richardson appeared to have the inside track. He and Lane wrestling for the football, but they were both out of bounds, so incomplete.
You know, what a transformation for Mike Richardson. We talk so much about Brady Quinn, but man, Mike Richardson has made play after play this year for the Irish. Perfect coverage, you know, in front of him and behind him. It was a Duke way behind and Richardson in front, trying to squeeze a corner out in there. But, you know, if that's in the field to play, that would have been an interception for Richardson.
So Carney in punt formation. And the dangerous Tom Zibikowski awaits the punt. Zibikowski hit once, hit twice, and taken down.
Zibikowski is down.
Sure, special teams coverage. Pruitt makes the tackle, 34-yard punt, only 1 yard on the return. But Syracuse still has a three-point lead.
I've got bad news. I just got the packaging. Looks like
the second quarter this season has belonged to Notre Dame. They've come in trailing Syracuse here after being shut out in the first quarter for the first time. Walker fumbles the football, and luckily for him, it's bounds out of bounds. Tackled by Kelvin Smith. That's at least a half dozen stops for him in the first half.
Yeah, it is. You know, number eight, the middle linebacker, just showing great range. He comes to your screen, see him just kind of working his way down the line. Got his right hand on the ball, and that's a fortuitous bounce for the Irish. Good play.
Good defense by Syracuse, and the offense of the Irish a bit flat in the early going.
And remember, this is an Irish team that averages 38 points a game, so the Orange defense is really doing a good job.
Play action fake and a pump from Quinn. He's going down the sideline and overshoots Jeff Samardzija.
He wasn't even close.
Wayne Davis, Tenar Jackson, the corner.
Right.
Was not fooled by the pump
fake. Jackson on the coverage for the Orangemen.
Tenar Jackson does a terrific job. It just really wasn't fooled at all. But, you know, Brady Quinn the last few weeks has been phenomenal on deep balls. You know, he gives his receivers. But look at that. Well, this is when passes have been in the air for 20 or more yards. 10 of 17, 300 yards, 4 touchdowns. That's just over the last 3 weeks. So he's become a very, very good deep ball thrower. And he's been 2 of 3 today on deep ball throws. Passes in the air 20 yards or more.
Third down 11. The Irish are 0 for 4 on third down so far. Pass, short hop, snowball, incomplete.
You know, caused the short hop was Kelvin Smith again on the blitz inside.
Another sputtering drive by the Irish sends Fitzpatrick out to punt on fourth down.
Watch number 8 come right at Brady Quinn. No chance. And then number 20, Anthony Smith, no relation, almost, you know, forces a poor throw by Brady Quinn. So really good defense by the Orange. And Greg Robinson serves as not only head coach, but defensive coordinator.
Fitzpatrick will punt it to Bruce Williams. Better than his first punt. Williams takes it. Shakes the first man. Then driven back from the 15-yard line. Punt covered 46 yards. 6 yards on the return. So a net of 40. Anthony Fasano on special teams makes the stop. Still 3-0 Orange.
This car in its class doesn't mean leaving intelligence, beauty, and control behind. Introducing all new 306 horsepower IS from Lexus.
So third down now. They've converted 1 of 4. And of course, Notre Dame still looking for their first third down conversion of this first half.
Single coverage down here in the bottom.
And they're going to run it instead to Jones.
That's a lot of confidence in your defense, or maybe not enough confidence in your passing game.
Yeah, perhaps the latter. Ronald Talley stringing the play out, makes the tackle for Notre Dame, setting up a fourth down punting situation for Carney.
Notre Dame on the play. That's fourth down.
Carney, by the way, the top punting average in the Big East. The cynics will say he's had plenty of practice, plenty of opportunity.
10 punts last week.
Came into the game having punted 67 times.
In his career, he's had 12 punts blocked.
I saw Zbikowski awaiting the Kearney boot. Off the side of his foot. Takes a lateral bounce and out of bounds. So a big field position gain for Notre Dame. After their defense tries to jumpstart their offense, Anastasio might have gotten a hand on it, partially blocked, perhaps. Let's see.
But, you know, the missed opportunities earlier in this game, Tom, that was the penalty that would have that nullified the touchdown to Stovall, and then a missed field goal, and then the drop third down pass by Samardzija, something we haven't seen much, and then the blocked field goal. That's exactly why Syracuse leads this 3-0, but the Irish with great field position.
Kearney's punt only covered 20 yards. Walker dancing.
Darius Walker.
Tommy Harris drags him down.
Four first half drives for the Irish. Punt, missed field goal, blocked field goal, punt. That's not what Charlie Weiss is accustomed to seeing from this dynamic offense. You know, last week he had 9 possessions and scored touchdowns on 6 of them. This is a, you know, pretty formidable defense, though, Syracuse.
On 2nd and 7, Quinn looking over that defense. Samardzija to the 25.
Steve Gregory on the tackle, number 25. He's the man that made the
Block field goal. Kellen Pruitt got a piece of it as well. So it's a first down for the Irish.
First down at the 25.
And there's the yellow line marking that first down. Today's 1st and 10 line brought to you by Xerox. Ball placed at the Syracuse 25-yard line. Quinn lost it for Stovall. Touchdown.
You know, Tom, you can't cover him any better than this. Steve Gregory, number 25, who's 5'11", he's not a short cornerback, has him perfectly covered. But just great body position by Maurice Stovall. Looked exactly like last week, didn't it? And a touchdown catch against, 3 of them against Navy. So that's 9 touchdown catches in the last 4 games.
And wow. For Brady Quinn, it extends his record, 15 consecutive games with a touchdown pass. As Fitzpatrick attempts the extra point, and it is good. So the beneficial field position, Notre Dame finally scores. It's Maurice Stovall, his 10th touchdown reception of the season, 7-3 Irish. Irish at the 9:09 mark of the first half. Kareem Jones and Curtis Brinkley will await the Fitzpatrick kickoff. There they are.
And they desperately need some field position with the way their offense has struggled in the passing game.
Fitzpatrick's kick taken by Brinkley. Brinkley dropped at the 25-yard line where Syracuse offense will take over after Brady Quinn tosses the touchdown pass.
I'm going to, you know, look at this alley-oop touchdown, but watch the block by Darius Walker. This is the third time that he's picked up a blitz that allowed his quarterback to step up in the pocket, this time allowing him to get the ball to Maurice Stovall for a spectacular catch, another spectacular catch. Darius Walker, you know, you don't talk about that much, just, you know, protecting your quarterback, but that's 3 times he's picked up the blitz.
Charlie Weiss congratulated him. Actually, in the passing game, he didn't even play last year because he couldn't pick up blitzes. Patterson is sacked back to the 15-yard line by Derek Landry.
We talked about some of the Syracuse guys picking up the ball. Derek Landry has got a pretty good first couple of steps as well. Plays inside number 66, going right through the center, Justin Outen, and into Perry Patterson.
Syracuse was able to get Damian Rhodes back on the field after being shaken up earlier.
In the past, this has absolutely been a screen down for the Orange.
So second down and 18 back at the Syracuse 17-yard line. Again, trouble down for the Orange offense.
And a quarterback.
And a flag comes flying.
They were going to correct snap to Damian Rhodes.
All start, number 76 on the offense. 5-yard penalty, remains second down.
They have actually both quarterbacks in there at the moment. Fields now going out, but there's Joe Fields, who was on for that play.
Yeah, it was going to be one of those old trick plays.
Right.
Direct snap to Damian Rhodes, who's been trying to maybe get it to Joe Fields, who's a pretty good athlete. But the penalty wasted and puts it second and 23. I expect a screen.
Instead, it's Rhodes fighting just to get back to the line of scrimmage. And Notre Dame's just daring them to throw the ball. Well, Corey Mays makes the first initial hit.
Tom, don't you have to? I mean, you're 1-8. I mean, you know, there's really nothing to lose. This could be, a dangerous Syracuse team, but you have to take some chances. And, now they're in, third and forever. And they're going to punt the ball away, perhaps, and give Notre Dame great field position again.
Maurice Crum got a piece of that tackle, too. I wonder if his dad will give him a good grade on that.
Maurice Crum's father grades every single play. He usually gives him, what he told us yesterday, a C.
Well, he was an All-American linebacker, his dad, Maurice Sr., at Miami. Penalties will stop that play. And but Maurice Jr. says, we watched.
Prior to the snap, false start. Number 76 on the offense. 5-yard penalty. Remains third down.
Starosky with the penalty call. Maurice Sr., he said, we look at his tapes, but I don't get to grade him, Maurice Jr. says, because all we see are his highlights.
Yeah, absolutely.
We don't see every play. There's Maurice.
He calls his father immediately after every single game. Dad watches from home with a notepad in hand and calls in the grades.
After the penalty, it's third down and 28.
Yeah, more penalty yards, Syracuse, 19, than passing right now.
Send Tim Lane in motion to reset. And hand it off to Rhodes. That's just conceding, isn't it, Pat?
Absolutely. I mean, and think about Damian Rhodes, a guy who's rushed for over 800 yards with, a team that just not been able to throw the ball with any success at all. They've had 22 offensive plays, 17 of which have been running plays.
So once again, Carney will punt. And this one will be from the Syracuse end zone. Zivikowski will accept it. The last one by Carney only went 20 yards. Low. Zivikowski takes it at the 48 of the Orange. Got away from one man and a second. And then driven out of bounds and flipped over. Out of bounds. The punt covered 37, 8 yards on the return. Well, before Brady Quinn suited up for the Irish, he played in the U.S. Army All-American Bowl. So don't miss the country's top prospects playing one last time as a high school senior and making their college declarations. That's the U.S. Army All-American Bowl here on NBC Saturday, January 7th.
I was down there last year for that game. Boy, there were some good-looking high school athletes, but some great wide receivers.
So the Irish again with good field position at the 40 of the Orange. Just under 6 minutes to go in the first half. Toss it to Walker. Big hole. Walker's button down at the 29-yard line. First down Irish. The play covered 11 yards.
Eyes up, patient, and as soon as he sees that big hole, he's off. Good block by Ryan Harris, number 68. And then it was Maurice Stovall who had a nice block on the outside as well. Tight end Carlson.
Walker, who's had 100-yard rushing games against Pitt, Michigan, Michigan State, Washington, and last week against Navy, already has carried for 62 yards today. Injured Orange player. it's Tony Jenkins. Tony Jenkins shaking up on the play, sophomore from Springfield, Virginia.
A screenplay the Irish tried to run, read it perfectly. Number 51, left part of the screen. Just getting a piece of the ball carrier. Just gets rolled, left arm rolled over by a couple of teammates. Hustling play down the line of scrimmage by Tony Jenkins.
So Jenkins to the sideline as Greg Robinson gets his starting front back in there. Drame and Thorner coming in to join Weish and Lacoste.
You know, the defense has played so well, but their offense is going to have to take a couple of chances. Because they have not even thrown the ball when it's been, second and forever.
Quinn with time, then the protection breaks down, but he finds Samardzija for the touchdown.
Jeff Samardzija is their Z receiver. Stovall's the X, Samardzija's the Z, their flanker. Right in the middle of the screen, perfectly thrown ball. See him catch, use the hands that time, Tom. Again, what steals the ball away from anybody that has a chance at it? And then he's so good after the catch because he's strong. Charlie Weiss was saying, even though he's 6'5", he kind of maneuvers around like a much smaller receiver.
No time to celebrate. He's on to hold on the Fitzpatrick conversion attempt. Takes down a high snap.
Nearly blocked by Gregory.
And almost got it again, didn't it? It does split the uprights. The extra point good. So the last two passes by Brady Quinn have gone for scores. And for Samardzija, his 13th touchdown catch of the season. It's 14-3 Notre Dame.
So I was talking with my broker the other day. It was the usual small talk, you know. How's the kids? How's the family? All that. And then it dawned on me. When you think about all the years I've been paying those big commissions on everything we've bought and sold, were we really discussing my kid's future or his kid's future?
At Hyatt Hotels and Resorts, you'll find Wi-Fi in the guest room and beyond. Here.
He said, give him the blue steel look. Option on second down. Patterson keeping, draws a flag. In Duque and Mays hit him. And the face mask penalty against the Irish.
They were in that option play. It's so weird when you see defensive players run away from the ball carrier, which Zipakowski did on that one.
Personal foul, face mask, number 18 on the defense, 15-yard penalty from the end of the play, first down.
There's Indukwe grabbing the face mask, good call.
Isn't that blue steel look we were talking about,
right?
Brady Quinn?
Yeah.
You remember the movie Zoolander, don't
right?
you? What do you think? Is that it?
That's
pretty close.
That's what Samardzija says. Give him that blue steel look.
Yeah, it's pretty good to be Brady Quinn these days. He's got everything going in school and certainly on Saturdays. Has a legitimate shot, I think, being invited to New York for the Heisman Trophy ceremonies in a few weeks.
And will be the favorite, maybe, to win it like next year. Sack for the defense as they are making their presence known now. Landry and Mays collapsing quarterback Perry Patterson.
Yeah, I tell you, the third sack by Corey Mays this year, number 46, right up the middle, kind of on a delay blitz. And then from behind, Derek Landry. You know, Landry kind of forced him right into Corey Mays, so give half of that to Derek Landry and half to Corey Mays.
Meanwhile, Justin Outen is injured, the center for the Orange.
Worked on by the Traders.
.434 remaining in the first half, and Notre Dame, after a sputtering start, leads Syracuse 14-3.
Remember, Syracuse just couldn't get much going in the second quarter, and Charlie Weiss played the field position game.
Right, you know? And of course, the second quarter all season long has belonged to Notre Dame once again today.
Well, Notre Dame has actually scored more points in the second quarter alone than Syracuse has the entire year.
And counting the two touchdowns in this quarter, Notre Dame has outscored its opponents 145-26 in the second quarter this season. Gingerly to his feet.
It's Corey Mays, who's seven tackles today, three of them for loss and a sack. That's a good first half, would you say?
I would say.
But he has really emerged, I think, over the last three games in particular. The play signaled in. He looks down at his wristband and knows what defense is going to be called.
So without leaving the game, Carroll Madison moves over from guard to center, and Mike Skoroski comes in at left guard.
And I tell you, if you're an offensive coordinator, you always worry about that first snap with a new center.
Second down and 17 after the sack. Screen pass intended for Rhodes and incomplete.
Well, that's because Ronald Talley read the screen perfectly. The defensive end, only a sophomore getting his fourth start of the year. Here's Talley. Talked to him yesterday. And you know, watch how he just kind of reads the screen, feels it. He feels the running back Rhodes just kind of follows him out. His aunt and uncle live here in South Bend, and his mom, Tina Turner from Detroit, comes every single Saturday to watch her son Ronald play. She was the one really got him to go to Notre Dame.
Yep, she appreciated the academic side of life. The Notre Dame scheme of things. Rhodes going along, gets to the 35-yard line. Corey Mays makes another stop.
Corey Mays was in there.
And once again, Syracuse will have to punt.
Yeah, you know, they just watch number 46, Corey Mays. And again, just stepping in through traffic. And the eighth tackle of the day now for Corey Mays. Had a big first half.
And a good field position likely again for the Irish after Carney will punt to Zbikowski.
Well, we know, Syracuse cannot get themselves in third and longest. They're not even going to attempt to throw. They need to be in third and twos.
Pressure, but Carney got it away and a nice one.
Flag down.
There's a flag down. Zbikowski collars it. Picks his way forward and finally grabbed and taken down. Pruitt wrapped him up first. The flag flies after that scrimmage.
One, I think the punter may have been rough to run into, and then a late flag.
Stopped by several people, never went down before the whistle. Turned it out to the 37.
Twice.
You see he's disagreeing?
I was thinking of something a little stronger. The official appeared unperturbed.
Well, sometimes the priests around here, ears turn red.
And gets an explanation, does Coach Weiss, from Dennis Hennigan. It's a Big East crew.
I think they actually called holding. It looked like it was a holding.
That's holding against
Syracuse.
Syracuse. Yeah. And personal foul against Notre Dame.
Penalties during the play, holding number 26 on the offense is declined. After the play was over, personal foul on Notre Dame, 15-yard penalty from the end of the play, first down.
The penalty being declined, do you? that time. Here's the end of the phase. Zivakowski, I think they're going to call it the personal foul on Zivakowski here, who kind of hits Wayne Davis.
Hand to the face there. That's
yeah, that's the penalty. I don't understand the holding penalty being declined, but unless the Irish get it.
Walker and Thomas split backs in the backfield here.
Last two possessions have been pretty productive for the Irish.
Sintasano in motion. Quinn makes one way, stepped up to avoid the sack, and finally completed it to Thomas. And Travis Thomas caught from behind at the 30-yard line.
If only Tony Jenkins, number 51 for the Orange, had kind of stayed with the screen for the second time. He read the screen perfectly, Tom. But when he saw Brady Quinn scrambling, he kind of stopped. Well, he's playing nose tackle. It's kind of a double screen. And Tony Jenkins, the nose tackle, had really taken it away. But he thought Brady Quinn was going to be sacked, which nobody seems to be able to do much this year, do they?
And this is a perfect example of the way he's been able to avoid those sacks, stepping up, just dodging like a matador, and then getting it to Thomas, who's caught from behind by Jerry Mackey. But setting up a second and two, an 8-yard gain on first down. Walker, patient as he waited for a block, which enabled him to keep from being trapped in the backfield. Got not much, but could have been worse. Another Ron Paulus record by the books.
That one will be broken. He tied that one. I think it's safe to assume. I'm going around a limb here, Tom. This will be broken this series.
This play?
Could be.
Well, it's third down and short. Right. Third and one.
He keeps it up. They're going to change his last name to what? Quinsman or something? PR department around here?
Well, does it rhyme with Heisman?
Well, it's trying to.
Thomas. Stop.
Travis Thomas.
Close to the first down. That yellow line marking the first down yardage.
It's interesting, we were talking to Travis Thomas a couple weeks ago. He said, you know, I'm not one of those running backs that's afraid of contact. And Charlie Weiss likes to put him in those short yardage situations and uses him much differently than he uses Darius Walker.
There will be a measurement.
Close enough that they'll call out the chains for the measurement.
So Darius has had a nice job of protecting his quarterback, Brady Quinn.
Yeah, we didn't really expand on the thought, but last season as a freshman, he really wasn't in on passing downs because he had trouble picking up the protections.
It's a liability.
And then now, not only is he in on passing downs, he's become an excellent receiver. He's caught almost 30 passes, 28 passes. And obviously doing a good job of protection as well. You saw the measurement, just a bit short. And Notre Dame has not converted on 6 third down attempts all season. And so they'll try it on 4th down here.
Now, Brady Quinn is, in this situation is
I said all season, been all game.
Yeah,
sorry.
Right. His quarterback sneaked successfully twice against USC, remember? In the same court, empty backfield, quarterback sneak.
Empty backfield, quarterback sneak for the first down. Nice call, Pat. Like the Irish are going to take a timeout with the clock at 1:31.
They had a real nice second quarter, and both Brady Quinn and Charlie Weiss would like to finish this off. But good block by Bob Morton, who came in at left guard. He's ordinarily a center. And then John Sullivan, who was playing center. And the two of those guys kind of cleared the way. Brady Quinn almost slipped and fell. See how powerful he is. We talked about him breaking tackles.
Well, yeah, I mean, he is powerful. 6'4", 230. So Notre Dame is 0 for 6 on third down conversions, but
wait for
2 for 2 on 4th. One timeout left for the Irish and 1:31 on the clock. Talked about Darius Walker picking up those coverages so well and getting to be a part of the passing game. He talked about you have to be smart to play for the Irish.
Well, when you play for a coach like Coach Weiss, I don't think there's any room for dumb football players. What I mean by that is, you know, his system and his style of play is so complex. You really have to be intellectual to even function in this type of system. The playbook is about the size of an Atlanta phone book. It's just incredible the amount of plays and different things that we're able to run now.
Darius from Lawrenceville, Georgia. Thus the reference to the Atlanta phone book. Not the right size.
smart kid, smart player.
From the shotgun, first down at the 34-yard line of Notre Dame. Quinn rolling to his right. Delivers downfield, overshoots, and thanks to Samardzija getting a hand on it, it would have been intercepted otherwise. Samardzija able to get one paw on it.
Just shows you how much confidence, though, that Brady Quinn has in Jeff Samardzija, doesn't it? Just throw it up there and just give, you know, give him a chance. Keep the ball in play. If he's not going to make the catch, he's going to make sure the defensive back doesn't.
Yeah, because Jackson had dead aim on
him. Oh, he did.
Second down and 10.
You know, they really haven't had a lot of two-minute drills, the Irish, that I recall, because they've kind of blown people out in the second quarter.
Quickly under center, and he tosses it out to Fasano, who dives to the 40-yard line. Yard Jackson in pursuit.
You know, Tommy, we talk about how Charlie Weiss changes things up. You know, we talk about that quick look pass to the X receiver and the Z receiver. That's the first time we've seen it this year. He's kind of a quick one to the tight end, Anthony Fasano, who is what they call the Y receiver. But the same play, just to a different guy.
And in their two-minute offense, third down and 4. Pressure on Quinn. Going down the sideline. Good coverage. Shelton running with Jackson.
Great coverage by Jackson. And a great rush by Ryan Lucas, number 94, who's done a good job of putting a lot of pressure. Here's Jackson.
Can't cover any better than that.
No.
With speedy Shelton.
Well, even Steve Gregory, when he was beaten for a touchdown, had Maurice Stovall cover well. So the corners for the Orange have played very, very well and forced an Irish punt.
Fitzpatrick ready to do just that to Bruce Williams.
Watch out for Smith on the block.
Nice punt by Fitzpatrick. Williams. You can hear the hit as he's taken down after a 6-yard return after a 48-yard boot by DJ Fitzpatrick.
I'll tell you, Anthony Smith is the guy you worry about, number 20. He's the guy they had. Has blocked 3 punts this year, 6 in his career, but Maurice Crum, you know, a starter, is a guy who was assigned to block him.
Bruce Williams, Orange will put it in play from the 19-yard line. Only 2 completions today. Pretty anemic passing stats, which to Orange fans is no surprise, I guess. Play it safe here with a handoff to Rhodes.
Well, you know, this is a team in transition. Greg Robinson came in and inherited 2 quarterbacks who, you know, primarily runners. I mean, option quarterbacks. It's a system they ran before. He's trying to change to a passing offense. Whereas Charlie Weiss comes into Notre Dame and inherits Brady Quinn, you know, who's a thrower, and that's the kind of offense he was going to use. So
Syracuse in the midst of a transition. With a lot of young players on offense and going to the West Coast offense. And some good recruits, too, headed to the Carrier Dome next season. 33 seconds on the clock. Draw play, Rhodes. And a little slide step. Couple of tough yards again.
Well, the Orange are not going to win this on offense. They're going to have to win it with turnovers on defense or some block kicks or something, because they're just not, they're playing so conservatively offensively. Just no chance of winning on offense.
And the final seconds will tick away for the second quarter. After Syracuse led 3-0 at the end of 1, Notre Dame, with that powerful second quarter we've seen all season, takes control of the game. And at halftime, Notre Dame leading Syracuse 14-3. Now it's time for the Lexus halftime show, so let's join Jimmy Roberts in our New York studios.
And thanks, Tom. Coming up on the Lexus halftime show, we'll take a look back at Notre Dame's season, the arrival of Charlie Weiss, and the emergence of Brady Quinn, including a memorable game with USC. Plus, we'll update you on all the scores in the top 25. We'll get to all of that right after these messages from your local station.
Tuesday, Earl sets out to get his father elected to office.
If you register to vote, you finally have a voice.
Sign me up.
And Lord willing, this will be the night he finally...
Crazy game this has been. A wild one, an 18-point swing put Michigan up 9 points before the Ohio State comeback late in the game. And then Ohio State scores a touchdown. Antonio Pittman with 24 seconds left, a three-yard run. So Ohio State with the slim lead there. But now it all becomes a waiting game because it's all about Penn State and Michigan State. It's simple. Penn State wins, and they get the BCS Big Ten title. They're up 3-0 over Michigan State. As you can see, it's funny. Paterno in his 40th season. A year ago, they wanted his resignation. Today, they probably want an extension on his contract. Virginia Tech and Virginia. First quarter, Marcus Vick looking over the middle, 8 yards, the touchdown to Josh Morgan. The Hokies up 7-0. Second quarter, Virginia Tech now leading by 17. Vick this time to the side, and Eddie Royal dances along the sideline for the 24-yard score. That made it 24-0, and this one would end in a romp. So the Hokies off a bye week bounce back after the home loss to Miami. And check out the rushing numbers for Virginia Tech. Virginia Tech 333 yards on the ground and 5 touchdowns. Moving to the SEC, the Iron Bowl, the 70th playing of this one. Auburn up big early. This one is always a big deal, but perhaps a little less so after the Tides lost last week to LSU. The winner here technically still alive for birth in the SEC title game, but they'll need an awful lot of help. Staying in the SEC, Kentucky and Georgia's second quarter. Kentucky leading at 3-0. Georgia quarterback DJ Shockley, the knee looks fine to Leonard Pope, 10 yards. Bulldogs up 7-3 still. Second quarter, and Georgia's Danny Ware goes right up the gut. 53 yards later, he's at the house. That makes it 21-3. And final in this one, 45-13, really no contest. Georgia bounces back after their last-minute heartbreak to Auburn last week and wins the SEC East. The finish, they finish the regular season next Saturday at Georgia Tech. And we mentioned earlier that it's a big rivalry day in college football. One of the most storied rivalries anywhere in the country takes place in the Ivy League, Harvard and Yale. The series dates back to 1875. Today in New Haven, Connecticut, the 122nd playing of the game, and it was a wild one. Now they are in the third overtime, and by the way, this is the first time in the history of this series, 122 years, that it's gone to overtime. Harvard was down 21-3. Liam O'Hagan, 3 turnovers, but they storm back, and it goes to 3 overtime periods. As we said, the first time in the 122-year history of this series that it goes to extra play. Turning to hockey now, an NHL matinee at Madison Square Garden here in New York City. Two of the most surprising teams in the league, the Rangers hosting the Carolina Hurricanes. To the ice we go, midway through the first, Rangers leading 1-0. Carolina's Eric Staal scores on the 2-on-1. His 14th goal ties the game at 1. Rangers answer, though, on the power play. Hurricanes goalie Martin Gerber with the save on Michael Nylander, but Aaron Ward puts the putt back in his own net. Nylander gets the credit for the goal, 2-1 New York, and then the Rangers again on the power play. The incomparable Jaromir Jagr, the cross-ice pass to Peter Prucha, makes it 3-1 Rangers. They hold on to win it 4-3. The Rangers avenge the Thursday night loss in Carolina and take over sole possession of first place in the Atlantic Division. Carolina drops to 14-4-1. And for all the latest NHL news, scores, and stats, log on to NBCSports.com. Check out a special feature by Bill Clement on why the Rangers can finally make the playoffs this season. It's all at NBCSports.com. And tomorrow, the NASCAR season comes to an end. The Nextel Cup champion will be crowned at the Homestead Miami Speedway. Most of the fall, it's been a two-man duel between Tony Stewart and Jimmy Johnson. Right now, Stewart leads Johnson by just 52 points, and if Stewart finishes ninth or better, he wins the title. By the way, he has finished at least that high in 19 of his last 21 races. Airtime tomorrow at 3 o'clock Eastern. And when we return, a look back at Notre Dame season. We'll do that in just 30 seconds. Don't go away. 11 weeks later, just about every single question has been answered.
You are going to have a hard-working, intelligent, nasty football team.
You know, Notre Dame has been kind of in the wilderness for a while, but they got the right guy in Charlie Weiss. He's the real deal. He's, you know, as good as advertised.
We always knew that Charlie Weiss was a tremendous offensive mind,
And I think now what we're seeing rather quickly is that he is a great leader of men.
Conway, a blocker. He's inside the 20. Here's Quinn looking to throw over the middle. Caught, touchdown. Final score 42-21. The Irish are going to pull off an upset, beating Michigan in the Big House.
I don't think there's any way that we would even be half as good as we are now without Brady Quinn. You know, he's such a great leader.
It's obvious that this was a young man with talent his first 2 years at Notre Dame, but it really took a mentor, someone like Charlie Weiss, I think, to come in and corral that talent.
Brady Quinn has thrown a touchdown pass now in 14 consecutive games.
To see him dissect top defenses in the country, to see him make decisions under pressure, he arrived in the big time.
Brady Quinn, in my mind, in the 2006 season, will be the quarterback in college football.
There's always that little element that just kind of takes over when it's in the middle of the play and you're after it's done, you're really not too sure what really happened, but you're just happy that it turned out pretty good.
Tom's Mikowski, he's determined to make the end zone and he scores the touchdown.
I said to you, at number 9's pretty good. Well, guess what? He's pretty good.
Have that happen in that setting with all of the hype that led up to it and the fact that here was an event that absolutely lived up to anything that anybody could have hoped.
Leinert on fourth down, in the pocket, goes down the sideline, it's caught! Touchdown, SC!
The Irish are crushed.
It's easy to be gracious when you've won a game. It's easy to do that. It's tough to be gracious when you've lost a game, especially a game that was as heartbreaking as that.
He has taken a team that's been down and beaten, and he's propped them up, dusted them off. He looks at them in the eye and says before game, we're going to beat USC. They don't think, this guy's crazy. They think, you're right, coach.
Charlie Weiss said, college football at Notre Dame is about respect. Respect for the traditions of the Irish and respect for your opponents.
The Notre Dame fans, college football observers are clear that this is going to be a coach who's going to put them back at the forefront of college football and make Notre Dame matter every year.
And just to reiterate what we said a little bit earlier, a win today against Syracuse and one next week at Stanford will make the Irish eligible for a BCS Bowl. A pretty good start to the Charlie Weiss era in South Bend. At NBCSports.com, click on a special section, NBC's Notre Dame Central, for much more on the Fighting Irish. Plus, check out Pat Hayden's analysis, including his look at the impact the Irish seniors have had on the team's success this season. It's all at NBCSports.com. And we told you that Harvard-Yale was a wild one in a third overtime. Here's how it ended. Clifton Dawson, a 3-yard touchdown run in the third overtime. And for the first time in the 122-year history of this series, one team has beaten another for 5 consecutive years. That would be Harvard winning the first ever triple overtime game in the entire Ivy League. So a great day of football rivalry Saturday across the United States. No better game than the Ivy League. It's halftime, I should say, in South Bend. Notre Dame leading Syracuse 14-3. We send it back to Tom, Pat, and Lewis right after these messages from your local station.
This has been the Lexus Halftime Show. Lexus and their passionate pursuit of perfection.
Robinson noted, and as Pat noted also in the first half, the Syracuse defense, because their offense struggles so much, they need a turnover from their defense.
Yeah, can't win without them. defense, though, as you said, didn't turn the ball over. And, they've been averaging three turnovers a
game. That's a positive.
Right.
Syracuse will get the ball after the Fitzpatrick kickoff. Jones and Brinkley. This will be Curtis Brinkley. To the 20-yard line where the Orange will put it in play.
Curtis Brinkley on the
return. And as the offense trots out on the field, we'll look at our serious halftime stats.
Well, you see the rushing yards pretty Anthony even, Salvador, but the passing yards, 14 passing yards by Syracuse. But look at both teams on third down. So both defenses playing pretty good third down defense. But really, I just don't think Syracuse was aggressive enough on third down. It was third and 20 and running draws and things. So they're going to have to take some chances.
Perry Patterson, who started the game, starts second half.
Wow. Look at that first down play selection. You're always looking for balance.
Mike Richardson not at his normal corner spot. Leo Farine starts the second half for the Irish with a penalty marker down.
Richardson has played well all year. And
false start, number 85 on the offense. 5-yard penalty, remains first down.
And nearly, there he is. There's Mike Richardson. Remember, he almost had that interception in the first half and got lost in a web of players on the Notre Dame bench. And there's generally the nickelback, Leo Farine, who's played well in that fifth spot.
So the Orange start in a hole after another penalty. Justin out in the center, who was shaken up in the first half, is back in the game. Play action fake and a first down pass.
About ball placement, you should talk about ball placement. You got to get out in front of the guy, let him catch it, run. But the receiver just struggling to catch the ball, trying to get to the fullback Evans, and then Leo Farine, just a beneficiary of a poorly thrown ball that bounced right into his hands.
Off the hands of Breon Evans and into Farine's for the touchdown.
Bill Lewis has done a great job in his defensive secondary.
Bad looking point after that does make it through.
Wow.
The third interception return for a touchdown this season for Notre Dame. Zipikowski had two of them. Here's Leo Green, the sophomore. Springfield, New Jersey's finest.
To the fullback, Brian. And then, Leo Green just happens to be right there, and the ball bounces to it in his lap. You mentioned the third touchdown return by defensive backs on interceptions this year.
Syracuse from the 30. Damian Rhodes hauled down from behind for a loss of one by Brandon Hoyt.
Hey, Brandon Hoyt, right, in his last game here at Notre Dame Stadium, is having a good one, isn't he, Tom?
We'll make sure everybody remembers him today.
Yeah. Second time it's kind of a late delayed blitz. It's his fifth tackle on the day for Brandon Hoyt, but kind of playing a deep inside linebacker. And a lot of negative plays he's caused in the last 3 years.
Fake to Rhodes. Patterson in trouble. Unloads it, and it's caught. Flag is down. Kowaleski, the tight end, makes the reception. It'll be a first down, a gain of 14 if it stands.
Kowaleski is the guy that, what a disappointing senior year he's had in terms of what he was hoping for. He'll be against the Orange. Kowaleski, a guy who grew up a Syracuse fan, used to sit up in the stands in row or section 317.
Ineligible downfield, number 76 on the offense. 5-yard penalty from the line of scrimmage. Repeat second down.
Skoroski downfield, wipes out a first down catch.
Here's a guy that played his last home game last week at the Carrier Dome. Said he grew up as a big fan, always dreamed of playing for Syracuse, battled some injuries, and then 1-8 record his senior year.
Yeah. whistled against the Orange.
They only had 14 passing yards.
Option. Pitch to Rhodes. Rhodes got by Indukwe. Chased out of bounds by Perrine.
Damian Rhodes. Leo Perrine ran him out of bounds.
Greg Robinson has had a tough first season.
He's an interesting guy. You know, the fifth of eight children in his family. His father, a World War II veteran, actually shot down over Yugoslavia.
Spent some time in a German prison camp.
His father became a lawyer only because Greg's mother wouldn't let him become a coach. But he became a very good lawyer. Two of his brothers are successful lawyers.
And Coach Robinson with his wife, two brothers, two sisters here today, about 40 family and friends total. Third down and 11 for his team. Patterson with time throws it short. Zbikowski tried to make the interception, almost had it.
Pass was intended for Nicholas Chestnut.
Chestnut was the intended receiver and had a step behind Zbikowski, but the pass short.
Yeah, number nine, right in the middle of the screen. Remember that pass he intercepted a couple weeks ago against Tennessee, just playing in the hole, as they say it. It's kind of a little, you know, over the middle, almost like a deep linebacker. Given the turf here, is the best 1-2 punch combination.
Zbikowski awaiting that Kearney punt. Nearly blocked. Maybe got a piece of it, as a matter of fact. Deflected.
Anastasio, I think. Chase Anastasio, I think, got a piece of it.
And so the Irish will have good field position, only a 25-yard punt. After Anastasio got a paw on it.
That's 13 block punts in his career.
The Chevy Red Tag event is here, delivering the number one selling cars, trucks, and SUVs in America. Most of them tagged with great holiday prices. The price on our tag is the price you pay, not a penny more. Now, get an 06 Cobalt LS Coupe for the Red Tag price of $12,937 after cash back. The Chevy Red Tag event. See red, save green. See your local Chevy dealer today.
Well, on cable with HD TV, your place for high-definition sports programming. And by ADT, America's residential and commercial security leader. An even 13 minutes on the clock as Notre Dame takes over at its own 45-yard line, up 21-3. Darius Walker tried to get a block from Schwab, who fanned on his man. And then he's taken down by Tommy Harris for a loss on the play.
Well, what a turnaround for the Irish in the first and second quarters on offense. They got went nowhere against this Orange defense that played so well in that first quarter. You see that less than a half yard. Then second quarter, which has been their explosive quarter, average over 5 yards per play.
Second down and 11 after Walker lost a yard on that first down carry. Make it to Walker. And Quinn with time finds Carlson. Tight end. And Gregory stops him after Carlson catches his sixth ball of the season.
You know, at senior day, Mark Lavore, number 73, the right tackle there, gave Brady Quinn plenty of time to make that throw. Actually, a graduate student here, graduate degree with anthropology. 35th start for Mark. A guy that has really come on, played very well, particularly the last part of this season. And has a chance of having a big NFL career, long NFL career.
6'6", 254. Quinn just standing there until he finds Stovall in the middle of the defense. And Stovall racing, tries to cut back and is caught at the 11-yard line. Ball came loose.
Yeah, they called it down. One official called it down. Field judge called it down.
Gregory and Davis chased him down. Still about a 40-yard gain.
You know, Brady Quinn has had a big difference in the play this year, but how about Maurice Stovall? He's down. The ball caused the fumble. And Maurice Stovall just, you know, trying to get the ball snapped. Notre Dame trying to get the ball snapped before the review. But I thought they were going to call us the fumble.
Yeah, it looked like
it's under review.
Replay.
And they will review it, but I think they'll come to the same conclusion we had, which is he has it until he hits the ground. The ground cannot cause a fumble altogether now.
What about a quick little move there by Maurice Stovall, though, Tom? You know, last year, much heavier than this year. It's one thing Charlie Weiss said to him. They lose some weight, and boy, has it paid off.
Well, it's going to pay off.
Indeed. Yeah, when the ground causes that fumble without a doubt.
When the NFL draft is held, I think you can count on Stovall.
Yeah, he went actually from a guy probably that wasn't going to get drafted and working in sales for some company to being a guy drafted on the first day.
I think he could have done most anything he wanted. As we spoke to him, he's very composed, very quiet, introspective young man. And I still remember what his mom said about him, that I'm most proud that he is a gentleman.
After review, the play stands as called.
Except the defensive backs, Tom.
And looking at some of his downfield blocking, it's almost gotten to be as good as his receiving skills.
Well, see the quickness there? I mean, he just caught it and went. No waste of time. That long stride of his 6'5 frame.
So the call on the field stands. Still Notre Dame's ball just inside the Syracuse 10. Walker. Walker made a nice cut. And swung out of bounds by Anthony Smith.
Good patience, good eyes, but great block by number 89, John Carlson, the tight end.
Anthony Smith.
Boy, and you know what? If you wait and watch these things develop, see the number 89 just kind of push Tommy Harris out of the way. And Darius Walker, with his good vision, sees it, waits for it, and makes a nice game.
And Walker bidding for another 100-yard rushing game.
Well, if he gets there, sixth of the season.
Deflected and incomplete, intended for Samarjan. Has tipped out the line of scrimmage. Pruitt.
Kevin Pruitt's a guy that Greg Robinson was saying, boy, he's got long arms and range. Right here, gets his left hand there. You know, he's 6'4", and Greg Robinson said, boy, I wish I had him for another year. He's a senior, he got next year. A lot of tackles, gets in the passing lane a lot, as you saw there with his wingspan.
Flag is down. Still fighting for yardage, but there was a penalty marker came down just as the play unfolded.
Passes to Fasano. There's a flag in the backfield.
And looks like Syracuse will have the option. Fasano on the catch, carrying tacklers with him toward the goal, but all for naught.
Illegal shift. Number 68 on the offense never got set. That penalty is declined. Fourth down.
It's Ryan Harris, left tackle. So fourth down, as the Irish continue to draw blanks on third down conversions. But they are 2-for-2 on fourth down, and they're going to go for it here.
That makes it fourth and goal and three.
You know, there's so many weapons they have among Fasano and Samarza and Stovall, all three of them 6'5". And Syracuse will use one of their timeouts.
Stopping the clock at 11:10, third quarter, and Notre Dame going to go for it on fourth down, fourth and goal from the three-yard line. That'll be the situation when we come back to
this route.
Empty backfield as Walker goes in motion. Quinn hits, he delivers the ball, and it's incomplete.
Now it's Kelvin Smith again, Tom. Middle linebacker for Syracuse. Started the game so well, continues to play well here in the third quarter. Smith right in here. Again, just read the play and then timed that little cross blitz they've run successfully. You know, it's a two-man blitz between himself and Syracuse. The Irish have had trouble picking it up.
Yeah, you're right. That cross blitz has confused the Notre Dame blitz pickup package several times today. The problem is the Syracuse offense, just one first down their last six possessions and just four for the game. And they're deep in their own territory. They take over at their own 3-yard line. Rhodes, if they give him forward progress, they will. Averting a safety, it'll be marked out to the 1-yard line. Forward progress. Derek Landry almost beat him to the spot.
All is marked down at the 1.
Crosses. Ball is over.
Yeah. Good call.
Yes, absolutely. Absolutely. You know, if Syracuse is not going to throw it, I don't know why Joe Fields, who's more of a runner, an option quarterback, they don't give him a shot maybe to run some options, Tom.
They certainly have nothing going on this side of the football. And now it's even worse. Back to the 1-yard line. Rhodes. Pounded ahead for another yard. Zbikowski met him.
I think you have to throw it. Well, the first thing, you have to get it out to the at least the 5-yard line so your punter has the full 15 yards. You don't want the punt deflected. You know, give yourself a chance at least. You're 1-8, down 21-3. Give a receiver a chance.
Today, 1-8 third down conversions. In fact, they converted their first of the game and 0-8 since. Sails incomplete, intended for Moss.
Well, you know, think about what's happened. On offense, three times down here, Syracuse has had to punt the ball and giving Notre Dame great field position. They've turned it into two scores already, two touchdowns, and have a chance to turn into the third. So the Syracuse defense played well enough, certainly, to give Notre Dame a run today. Their offense, again, miserable.
Zbikowski is awaiting the punt. Carney from the back of his own end zone. Got it away, high, not deep. Zbikowski says, stay away from it, and it takes a Notre Dame bounce. And so once again, the offense of the Orange puts the defense in a bind, only a 23-yard punt.
The 26.
Tomorrow, it all comes down to this one race to decide the next L Cup champion. Tony Stewart leading Jimmy Johnson by 52 points. Find out who'll take it all tomorrow. That's 3 Eastern, noon Pacific at the Ford 400, beginning with a special one-hour Bank of America countdown to green here on NBC.
Good days. They've started on their own 44 for Notre Dame.
Average. Four. This one starts at the 26 of the Orange. Walker.
It's too bad, sir, just wasting a good defense. You know, Tom, this is could be a top 10 defense with some support from the offense, but just haven't gotten it this year. There's a guy who's had a great game.
Elvin Smith, as Big John Sullivan was in a standoff of his man, couldn't really drive him away, and Walker never had a chance to get going. In fact, lost a yard.
Else has had a good game for this Orange defense is Ryan Lacasse, number 94, the guy that has really put a lot of pressure right up here on Brady Quinn.
They get to Walker, and Quinn chased by some time, finds Walker in the flat, helmet knocked off by Jackson.
Lamar Jackson. Tommy Harris.
Darius Walker helps this team in some ways that, you know, you just can't read in the stats. We saw how he's
8 of 2,
kind of made some good blocks on some blitzes. This time as an outlet receiver. I think that's the second catch of the day for Darius, and it gets him to 30 on the season. Has a chance to maybe break the record for receptions by receiving back held by Bob Gladio.
Jackson actually hit him first. It was Harris that removed the helmet. Third down and 9. Can't haul it in. Low and behind Jeff Samardzija and incomplete. Another fourth down.
For Samardzija.
Well, this defense is
fourth down.
Maybe the best we've seen or Notre Dame has seen. You know, they played Tennessee's defense. They played the number one ranked USC team. But this Syracuse defense has played. That was a low ball for Samardzija.
So a fourth down field goal attempt by Fitzpatrick.
I'll tell you, Gregory, Steve Gregory over on the right side has come clean twice. Blocked one. He's over here. Blocked one and nearly got an extra point.
44-yard attempt, Fitzpatrick. Has it up and through. Fitzpatrick kicking for the final time at Notre Dame Stadium. Makes it 24-3. Three count. And Fitzpatrick will tee it up to kick it off for the Irish. Into the end zone for the touchback.
Reed Jones downs the ball for a touchback.
And let's listen to the undertones, the Notre Dame a cappella group.
Cheer, cheer for old Notre Dame. Wake up the echoes cheering her name. Send a volley cheer on high. Shake down the thunder, thunder from the hollow sky. Well, though the odds be great or small, Notre Dame will win over all. While her loyal sons are marching onward to victory, onward to victory, for Notre Dame.
The Irish do appear to be on their way to victory with a 24-3 advantage. Point.
Good play.
And Patterson finally just heaves it out of bounds.
Well, I'll tell you, if you weren't 6'4", 249 pounds, he goes down. Brandon Hoyt has been doing this all day long, hasn't he? There he is, off the corner.
Somebody needs to get a little piece of him or something. They just let him come untouched.
Yeah, you know, he's done that a couple times from the outside. We've seen it a couple times as an inside linebacker as well.
He came up with a towel that Patterson had on his belt.
That counts as a third of a sack.
That's it. That's the frustrating afternoon for the offense.
How about for their defense?
Rhodes.
Fading and Rhodes.
Ambrose Wooden rides him out of bounds.
You know, Syracuse did score 3 points, but really Ambrose Wooden, remember, he was the one that had that saving tackle in the first quarter on Damon Rose. And Ambrose Wooden has made some great hustle plays throughout the entire year for the Irish. Now, this was against Michigan. You know, just hustle, knocked the runner out on the 1 yard line. They fumbled on the next play against Purdue, knocked him out, an interception in the opening drive against Washington, and then against Tennessee, it's an interception. You know, he has just played brilliantly and really hustled. Tackles today for Ambrose Wooden.
And one of those tackles saved a touchdown on Rhodes' 51-yard run. Patterson scrambling. Got a block. And he has a lot of room to roam. Patterson will lumber out of bounds at about the 45-yard line, a gain of 22 yards.
And lumber is right. He was lumbering, wasn't he? He's got good field vision, though, does Terry Patterson. Ducked a couple of blitzers, including Brandon Hoyt, who's caused him some grief. Look at hustling Derek Landry. Maybe a block in the back. Indeed, right there, there was a block in the back.
44-yard gain.
Spot the ball at the 47 of the Orange. First down. Has to throw it away.
Only two completions to wide receivers today for Syracuse.
Second down.
And that's one of the reasons. Ambrose Wooden and Leo Farine.
Usually not a good sign.
Yeah.
And Patterson has gone all the way. He's taken every snap today. Joe Fields was on the field with Patterson when it appeared to be a trick play about to unfold, and it was stopped by penalty. There's Fields on the sideline. Rhodes gap opened up for him for a moment and then quickly closed as he crossed midfield. Abby Amiri caught him there.
You know, Tom, Greg Robertson was hired by Daryl Gross, the new athletic director at Syracuse, who hired actually Pete Carroll at USC when Daryl was there, and hoping, you know, the same kind of defensive mentality to get it turned around in Syracuse. Pete Carroll struggled his first year as well. Actually, he and Pete Carroll played in college together at Pacific and coached at North Carolina State, coached with the Jets together.
And both began their coaching careers at their alma mater. Rhodes is in motion, now resets to the top of the formation. Patterson, a short drop. Toss is complete for a first down. Caught by Alex Shore, the tight end. And it apparently is enough for a Syracuse first down.
He's a big target at 6'8". You know, he could play maybe for their basketball team. The size like that. Shore's eighth catch of the year. The tight end has been the recipient of most of the passes this year for the Orange.
So a fresh first and 10. Our first and 10 yellow line today brought to you by Xerox.
We'd like to see a lot more of that first and 10 line.
Well, this has been one of their better drives. It's the first quarter for sure. It started on their own 20. And now on the Notre Dame 38. Option, Patterson keeps. Got away from Hoyt, but can't get away from the pursuit of the Irish defense, led by Abby Amiri and Mays.
Victor Abby Amiri playing the option well. Brandon Hoyt, they saw a lot of it last week against Navy. Still well
scored. Victor Abby Amiri.
And Hoyt coming right off the corner, just the strength of Perry Patterson, and ran right through the tackle of Brandon Hoyt, which we don't see much doing.
No. Usually he is a sure tackler.
And looks like you go down. An injured Irish player.
Ronald Talley.
He's in for the injured Chris Fromm.
Ronald Talley
spoke to Ronald Talley yesterday, and he could have our jobs. What a voice.
Oh, boy. Wants to be a filmmaker. He's in film, theater, TV major here at Notre Dame.
Interested in all forms of entertainment, but he said, film director would be his ideal.
That was interesting. We said, parents look at recruiting much different than players. You want to have a pathway to the NFL, but for parents, they're always looking, hey, what happens if football doesn't work out? And that's why his mom really wanted to, number 99, didn't get to it early enough. His mom thought, Notre Dame would be a good choice for him, and it's turned out pretty well.
He's replaced by Justin Brown, sophomore from Clinton, Maryland. Fake toss, handoff to Rhodes. Trying to turn the corner with Hoyt in pursuit.
Justin Brown, the guy who just came in, made the snap.
Brown wrapped him up right at the sideline.
Yeah, Justin Brown's an interesting story, I think. He really wanted to play college basketball. He's right up here. And in high school, really didn't play football until his senior year of high school. And that was actually after the second game. He asked the football coach to come out after two games, and high school coach consulted with his captains, let him play, and one of those guys that may emerge into be a pretty good player over the next couple of years.
Went to Bishop McNamara High School in Forestville, Maryland. Born in Washington, D.C. From the shotgun, Patterson chased and can't get away. Sacked back to the 45-yard line by Corey Mays. 7-yard loss.
Boy, Corey Mays and Brandon Hoyt and Justin Brown got a piece of him as well. The blitz right up to Manoli even thought about blocking Corey Mays. And then at the end, you see 94 Justin Brown finish him off. Justin Brown also has a brother who plays defensive end at Howard University.
So what had been a good drive by the Orange fizzles out, and Carney is once again in punt formation. Zimikowski will accept it. Zimikowski makes it. A little bounce, but he recaptured it. A 32-yard punt with no return.
I don't see him fair catch much, do you?
No, rarely. Almost was sorry he did, but held on. holding call against the Irish. That'll place the ball back at the 14-yard line. Actually, declined the penalty, so it sets up a second down from the 14. Stopped him after a 12-yard gain, and we talked about the Heisman, the ballots going out. Heisman hopefuls, the defending champion would be one of them.
Yeah, Matt Leinart's had a better year than he had a year ago. His teammate Reggie Bush, about 1,800 all-purpose yards. How about Vince Young, the thrower and runner, run for over 700 yards for the Longhorns, and Brady Quinn, 29 touchdown passes, the fifth. How about Drew Olsen from UCLA? 30 touchdowns and only 3 interceptions.
Walker hit hard, dropped after a short gain by Kelvin Smith.
Tackle again made by Kelvin Smith.
Kelvin Smith has done himself proud on the bluegrass turf of Notre Dame Stadium today.
He sure has. You see the kind of the Heisman watch, Matt Leinart thrown for over 3,000, the 23 touchdowns, and he and Reggie Bush both playing later tonight against Fresno State. Vince Young.
Some talk about Lindale White, too, another Trojan in the mix.
I think Drew Olsen out of UCLA is then deserves the invitation.
Wide open in the middle of the defense is Shelton. And Matt Shelton slips down as he crosses the 40 of Syracuse for a 32-yard gain.
Well, and his last appearance at Notre Dame Stadium. 20th catch on the year for Matt Shelton, who has been, you know, last year was their absolute deep play, you know, receiver. Hadn't had a chance to play much this year, had injured knee, but had his moments, had some spots.
In the 32 yards.
Whatever, it was a ruck hit. Ismail's record he broke last year, I think it was.
Yeah. When he, as you mentioned earlier, that average of 25.7 a reception. Six touchdown catches a year ago. Looking for his first of this season. Walker spun down by Tommy Harris.
Good blocks by some seniors. Mark LaVore, Dan Stevenson. Did a good job of protecting. There's Mark LaVore.
What about every Thursday night when the offensive linemen go out?
Go to Bruno's.
Go to Bruno's Italian restaurant where they have an Italian buffet, all you can eat.
Mm-hmm.
Was $5 till the offensive linemen started coming. Now it's $7. There's Bruno. That is Bruno, the owner of Bruno's, the Italian restaurant where Notre Dame players have been going for years, and it's a tradition with this offensive line group. Brady Quinn goes with them sometimes, but Samardzija with a catch inside the 30.
Brady wouldn't get his money's worth.
No.
He did raise the prices, that $2.
I still think it's a losing proposition at $7
yeah,
all you can eat.
Absolutely, yeah.
We had some Bruno's pizza up here in the press box at halftime. Mm. Quite tasty. Sampled a piece.
Yeah,
and there's Bruno and his son to his left. Somebody calling him, telling him you're on TV.
Yeah.
Or maybe they're ordering a pizza.
Yeah. Full pepperoni. Those guys deserve some pizza. They play pretty well in the run game, the pass game, protected your quarterback.
Darius Walker, 25-yard line. Tommy Harris, credit for another tackle, but enough for the Irish first down.
Tommy Harris, number 92 for the Orange. Good guy, good player. Didn't play much the last couple of years, but Greg Robinson really likes him. Started him, already has a degree in information technology, getting his masters right now in information technology. Basically another one of those real long arm guys that wish he had for another season or two.
Academic All Big East a year ago. Had 9 tackles last week against South Florida in the last home game. They'll close out the season at Louisville next week. Carlson hit immediately when he made the catch by Steve Gregory.
Steve Gregory, a guy that Greg Robertson said is having a phenomenal year. You know, he was out-jumped by Sowell, but still good coverage. He blocked the field goal today. Good tackler. He's done everything. Well, last year he was a wide receiver and caught 38 passes, which would have led the team this year by a long shot.
And the Brooklyn-born player back to his days at Curtis High School in Staten Island, I believe that's where Curtis High School is, was a quarterback, a running back, a wide receiver, punt returner, kick returner, and as well as a DB here. Darius Walker. Weish got him on the sideline. As we tick down the final seconds of the third quarter. And that'll do it. The sign says four, fourth quarter coming up. At the end of three, it's 24-3. Back after these messages from your local NBC station.
Hi, I'm Eva Longoria, and I'm hosting Saturday Night Live with musical guest Korn. Hey, any of you guys into gardening?
Game of this season, the former Notre Dame student who returned to South Bend and turned things around on the Notre Dame campus this season. Darius Walker for first downs, tackled by Kelvin Smith.
The
thing about this was at the end of the third quarter, the playing of the 18-12 overture, and the students making the W with their hands. And not only has Coach Weiss made his presence known on the field, turning this offense into a juggernaut, but he's done such other things that have called in all the traditions of Notre Dame football and called on stars of the past and that connection between Notre Dame and its past. Quinn attempting the throw, and Carlton unable to snag it. And then he did things like the young man who was dying, let him call the first play against Washington and stuck with it despite the fact they were deep in their own territory. Then he visited the SC locker room after the game to tell them how proud they were of such a great game. Both teams played so well. And last week he took his team over to stand with the Navy players toe-to-toe as they listened to the Navy alma mater. So he's done all the right things both on the field and off the field, and this is his first season. Of course, it's a season that has extended now to 10 years. And after this pass by Quinn is incomplete, he was telling us that they've broken ground and poured the concrete for a new home, bought some land here in South Bend where his family plans to live. He said it's the house they were going to build in New Jersey when he retired. Instead, they're building it now because they're not going to leave. They'll maybe winter some in South Carolina, but their home is going to be here for the rest of the time. And he's building an indoor riding arena for his wife, and they have enough land where she can have some of her horses on their property. Building a baseball practice area for his son, Charlie Jr. So the roots are already extending deep here in South Bend and at the University of Notre Dame for Charlie Weiss. There's Charlie Jr.
I think he likes the game plan today, Charlie Jr.
Well, yeah.
Charlie Jr.
He'll find something.
His dad's toughest critic, he tells us every week.
James Weish, a senior from Roosevelt, New York.
Talking about James Weish.
Talking to Charlie earlier in the year, and he was telling us second of five kids in his family, kind of a working class New Jersey family, father an accountant, mom a nurse. And today, you know, parents just proud that all five of their kids went to college.
Darius Walker tying Autry Denson's record with his sixth 100-yard rushing game. As 19 carries, 101 yards. Fitzpatrick, field goal attempt, former walk-on now on scholarship, 29-yarder, splits the uprights good. Fitzpatrick missed one and had one blocked, but now he's found the range as the Irish have their lead.
It's a comfortable feeling knowing your annuity from Prudential can bring you a check every month for the life of your retirement. Prudential Financial, growing and protecting your wealth for retirement.
This season, they're needing a win at Stanford next week to be in the pool for the BCS Bowl.
Really to win 10 games.
Abby Amiri spun down. We were We were talking about all this to Charlie Weiss. As he yelled, everybody's going to be real happy about this BCS stuff if we make it. And right now, they have to be in the top 12 in the BCS standings. They're ninth, and they have to win nine games. If they go on and win today and next week at Stanford, they would satisfy that requirement. And he said, everybody's going to be real happy about it, and it is quite an achievement. Everybody's going to be happy except me. He said, I'm going to be thinking about how close we were to being unbeaten and playing maybe for a national championship.
Lost in overtime to Michigan State and a thriller to USC at the end of the game.
Option. And the pitch to Rhodes. Got a nice block. And
you ever had a head coach that was entirely happy?
No, that's true. It's just the nature of the beast.
Well, you know, he's got a program. These guys, same guys, really went 6-6 a year ago. As we said, have a chance if they win today and next week to have a 10-win season. I believe, you know, they have virtually everybody back next year. I think there will be a preseason number one team. And you mentioned it earlier. I think Brady Quinn has a chance of being the top Heisman preseason candidate. You have to win it, obviously. But a lot of good things going on here in Irish land.
Third down and seven for Syracuse. Patterson from the shotgun. Mays chasing him. He manages to unload it downfield, and it's incomplete. Intended for Rice Moss, who was running with Ambrose Wooden.
Tell you, Corey Mays has come cleanly so many times on blitzes right up the middle. There's a design there, a design flaw that allows number 46 to come unblocked up the middle. A lot, which he's done today.
And a familiar face on the field.
He had 10 last week, and this is his eighth today.
Carney's punt. Zibikowski, it bounced at his feet. The Notre Dame bounce, it'll be downed by Syracuse just short of the 50-yard line. Only a 32-yard punt.
Since 1978, the Hawaii Ironman's 140-mile human blast furnace has scorched the circuitry of the world's fittest athletes.
That's why Coach Weiss was saying he had a special feeling for these seniors, because not only did they help the team buy into the Weiss concept, but he felt a special place in his heart for them because of all they've been through. Walker.
You know, I thought, you know, Brandon Hoyt said, you know, first thing Charlie Weiss told his seniors, though, as you see the seniors, no eligibility left. Some good ones there with LaVore and Hoyt, Hayes, Patrick, etc. Dan Stevenson, Stovall's had a great year. But he said, hey, I'm not going to give up. So, you know, your senior class, we're going to win, try to win this year. We're not building a program for two or three years from now. He said, we're going to try to win with you guys. And I think all the seniors really respected that, respected him for that. And boy, they have won.
Quinn steps up and fires a strike to his baseball players, Samardzija.
Yeah. He throws some strikes. He was telling us yesterday he has a bunch of different pitches. Five different pitches does Jess Samardzija have. A bunch of them fastballs at over the 90-mile-an-hour range.
And what a future he has to contemplate, because he's going to play for the Irish baseball team in the spring, and in June will be the Major League Baseball draft. And as a junior, he'll be eligible for the draft, the Notre Dame pitcher. There are his pitches in that four-seam fastball in the 90s. Circle change, he said, was a work in progress. But he'll come back and play Irish football next season after one would presume a summer of minor league baseball, because you can sign a professional contract and play baseball and still be an amateur and compete in college in football. And then at the end of next season, he can decide whether he wants to go the football route or the baseball route.
Well, he's going to have some good choices. I thought it was interesting yesterday, though, when he said, see, it's coming back today. It's really important that we send our seniors out the right way today, their final home game, and it looks like they're going to do that. And on their way to Stanford next week for their final regular season game.
Second and five, handoff to Darius Walker. Nearly broke it.
Walker.
Finally, Smith makes the tackle. And the records continue to fall.
By Anthony Smith.
for Brady Quinn.
Wow.
Ron Paulus, saw him in the lobby the other day of the Goog Center. Yeah, he's seen all his records be erased by Brady Quinn. There he is on the sideline.
Very nice career.
Apparently not pleased with all this.
No, I think he's happy to see it broken and his team winning.
Walker.
Surprise. Preparation of this game, reading about the wide receivers, Notre Dame, Samarja and Maurice Stovall, both of whom have over 50 catches. There has not been a receiver with over 50 catches in over 25 years at Notre Dame. And they have two of them in Stovall and Samarja and Fasano, who has a chance. See, they have 1974 to 2004, didn't have a receiver with 50 or more receptions. And just shows you the kind of, it's not really a West Coast offense, it just kind of take what the defense gives you kind of offense.
Of course, the injured Raymond McKnight will be back in the receiving corps for the Irish next year. Play action fake, and Quinn going for the end zone, jump ball, and Samarja cannot quite call it in.
He called for the circle curve, but got the finger fastball.
You know what's going to be interesting, talking about coming back or not, is you see again how close this was, because Samarja is in the end zone, hangs up there, and Gregory able to catch up a little bit, but the ball just too high, just off the fingertips of Samarja. But Anthony Fasano, at Notre Dame, you have a chance. Even though you graduate, it's a different system. You can petition the university for another year of eligibility, and Fasano will have a choice to make whether he would turn pro at the end of this season or come back next year. Quinn's pass intended for Samarja incomplete.
Well, if I were Brady Quinn, I'd be lobbying my roommate, Anthony Fasano, to come back because they're going to perhaps do something special. Look at all the career ranks. What is it, 17 records he holds now?
Right.
Fourth down.
And touchdowns and yards.
Continuing with Fasano, Coach Weiss was saying the thing about a tight end, they don't rise too much in the draft. Even if he came back next year and had a sensational season, there's only a certain amount of places that a tight end can rise in the draft. So it's something that will have to be considered. Fitzpatrick lined up for the field goal attempt. 42-yard attempt. It is good, and the flag is down on Steve Gregory.
Shot out of a cannon.
And hit Fitzpatrick. Gregory blocked one earlier.
You know, I give Steve Gregory a heck of a lot of credit, though, because this is a guy, you know, you're down 24-3 and still coming off as hard as you can off the edge. It wasn't an intentional thing, but ran right into, you know, the finish of D.J. Fitzpatrick's kick. This is why you think Tony West wanted to get a lot of his starters out earlier if he could have, including his kicker. He's also the punter.
Personal foul, roughing the kicker. Number 25 on the defense, 15-yard penalty from the line of scrimmage. First down.
Penalty is for roughing the kicker.
Right up the corner of the kicker.
Personal foul, 15 yards, and it's a first down.
Just kind of a...
While he was in his most vulnerable position with that kicking leg in the air.
It was a pretty good angle that Gregory took. Surprised he actually ran into him. Well, that ends leads to some intrigue for next week, because, as we said, D.J. Fitzpatrick, very versatile kicker, punter, had a real good career. Won at least one game with the last second field goal against Navy a couple years ago.
A former walk-on that was put on scholarship prior to last year from this area.
A graduate student. And he graduated with a degree in accounting.
Given new life with the penalty, they hand to Darius Walker, picking his way forward to the 5-yard line.
Tackled by Tony Jenkins.
Tony Jenkins, Anthony Smith combine on the Syracuse tackle as we reach the 8:40 mark.
A gain of 7.
Well, this is a balanced team. You know, today has been not as productive a passing game as we usually see out of the Irish. They average over 325 yards a game, but a patient rushing day for Walker.
Walker on the play handoff. about the two-yard line. And just to wrap up the story about Pisano and whether or not he will turn pro, he has expressed an interest of coming back and maybe helping with a drive to a possible national championship with the Irish, and yet he'll just have to see where he thinks he will go in the draft. And what a valuable resource to have with Coach Weiss and all his connections in the NFL to help you with that decision. In fact, he says he's going to meet with all the draft-eligible players and their parents in December, the day of their banquet, to help them decide what they should do. And he said when the agents start feeding all these lines and these grandiose plans and stuff, he said, just tell them I'm clearing everything through Coach Weiss. He said that usually gets them off their back. Walker again.
This time, you know, he called for a burst, not one of those patient runs. And that's what he got. Good blocks by Ryan Harris, Dan Santucci.
So with Fitzpatrick shaken up, we'll have a new kicker.
Joya, I think it's...
Joya is the...
ordinarily the backup.
And no problem, Carl Joya. Kicks it up and kicks it through. So Carl Joya, with his first extra point attempt of the season, makes it 34-3.
She's over there.
Comcast is way faster than DSL and dial-up, so downloads don't take forever. Comcast high-speed internet. It's Comcastic.
Of all the places we fly around the world, we know one means more to you than any other. We know why you fly. We're American Airlines.
Can't read this. Can you read this?
I can't read this.
What's wrong with this?
It's in black and white.
Black and white's what's wrong with this?
Should be in color.
That is better. How'd you do that?
Xerox Color. It makes business sense.
Monday, the event you've been waiting for is finally here. Medium in 3D. For the first time, see her visions in 3D. And use the clues to solve the case.
Oh my God.
Medium in 3D, Monday on NBC. Get your glasses and TV guide and go to NBC.com for more.
34-3, the advantage for the Irish with 7:42 left.
Carl Joya will,
Kick off. And the deep men will be Bruce Williams and Curtis Brinkley for Syracuse. There's Joya,
Brinkley,
who sends it on its way. Short kickoff. Brinkley crosses the 30-yard line, tackled by John Carlson.
Well, there's Charlie Weiss, and his favorite phrase is, my guys are all day tough. He says that about you. He really likes you. How about Brady Quinn? All day, maybe all night tough. He's been unbelievable. Swap, the freshman fullback, really added some power. Brandon Hoy has had another great game today. Tough game, and maybe the toughest of them all. Zibby, Tom Zibikowski, former boxer.
And, Brady Quinn on the bench, on the all-day tough team, as Notre Dame calls a timeout, and they get 11 new players on the field.
And so their seniors can get a real nice round of applause.
And Syracuse facing a first down. There's a hug for Brandon Hoyt playing his last game. Syracuse today, Pat, 18 first down plays. One of them was a 51-yard run by Rhodes. The other 17 have a net of minus six.
My favorite word for that is yikes.
Look at the two linebackers that will be leaving after today, Hoyt, and leaving after their final home game today. They finish up at Stanford and have a bowl.
I think the biggest plug for them to fill next year, don't you think, the linebackers?
Mays and Hoyt.
Yeah. Maybe a couple offensive linemen, too.
Salvador's in the game. Borsetti, Bernaglia. Pass complete to Bruce Williams.
Complete to Bruce Williams.
Say, that's Brandon Harris making the tackle, number 36 for the Irish. An interesting story about Brandon Harris. I mean, he came here on a music scholarship from New Orleans.
Second and two.
Was looking for a college with a good, you know, music program. He came here, is going to play, does play the violin. He's going to be a performance major.
In the Notre Dame Symphony.
Yeah. Very interesting guy. Walked on, then got a scholarship right before the season.
Second down for the Orange. Short drop, the pass complete for a first down. Tough hit there as Kowalewski holds on.
Pass complete to Joseph Kowalewski.
Let's go down to Lewis.
All right, Tom, a quick update here on Notre Dame kicker and punter D.J. Fitzpatrick. He came off the field, as we saw, holding that right knee. They took a long look at him. He took a practice kick, but we saw Joya go out. I've been told that D.J. Fitzpatrick will not return in the game. But as I'm looking at him, he's kind of standing around. Doesn't look to be any terrible pain, so have to wait and see what that means for them using him against Stanford next weekend, whatever else may lie ahead. Tom?
All right, Lewis. And Syracuse forced to take a timeout. We'll take a break with the clock showing 6 minutes, 24 seconds.
I'm tempted to for a moment, and she feels better than ever, and we're on fire, making our way back from mine. I'm tempted free for a moment.
The road of life takes many turns. There are over 900 Chase credit cards to help you make the most of every one. Your choice, your Chase.
I've been to Louisville, Nashville, Knoxville, Longport, Hackensack, Cadillac, Fond du Lac, Davenport, Idaho, Jellicoe, Argentina, Diamantina, Pasadena, Catalina, Sequoia. I've been everywhere, man. I've been everywhere.
Right now at Comfort Inn, Comfort Suites, Quality, Sleep Inn, Clarion, and Mainstay Suites Hotels, you'll earn a free night after just two separate stays with Choice Privileges. For reservations, visit choicehotels.com.
I've been everywhere.
Choice Hotels. We'll see you there.
Hey, Jill. Ooh. Hey, honey. I know you don't think I need any more sports in my life, but I do. Boy, howdy do I. I need sports at home. I need sports in the car. I need Sirius Satellite Radio at Radio Shack, Jill. It's got 100% commercial-free music, and it's also got a Martha Stewart channel, honey, huh? And we can finally learn to make a wreath. Let's make a wreath. Yeah.
This holiday season, don't just get a gift. Get the right gift at Radio Shack.
These passengers are about to have their lives turned upside down. The Poseidon Adventure, Sunday 8, 7 Central on NBC.
Back at Notre Dame, 34-3. First down for Syracuse, 45-yard line. Nice step up. And Patterson's pass for the end zone. Incomplete. Intended for Quinton Brown. He threw that a long way.
Got a huge arm. Just haven't had a chance to use it much today. You know, a year ago, he actually completed 58% of his passes. This year, only 48% coming into the game, and it has not been real pleasant today in a passing game.
Rich Whitney chasing in, number 45. Also in the game, Shervanek, Boland, Mitchell, Chicatano, Casey Cullen. Brendan Harris is in. Jake Carney is in.
Jake Carney's from where?
Lexington, Kentucky.
I thought that would come up. Yeah. Casey Cullen, an interesting story, longtime Notre Dame family. period. His great-grandfather was a two-time All-American halfback here in the late 20s.
Delay a game. Penalty against Syracuse.
Delay a game on Syracuse. Move the ball back to the 40.
So after the delay penalty, it's second down and 15. And there's the Irish walk-on, Casey Cullen.
Yeah, they actually gave him a scholarship in August. He was a walk-on, but they gave him a scholarship, earned one.
Second down. Patterson just flips it complete to his tight end. And Kowaleski is tackled by Jake Carney. And we're talking about Casey Cullen's great-grandfather, Christy Fleet-footed Flanagan.
Yeah.
A two-time All-American halfback, 26 and 27. Ooh. He was Fleet. Look at that.
Look at that. Very Fleet-footed.
And now Casey getting on the field here at Notre Dame Stadium.
Quite that Fleet-footed is his great-grandfather. But, you know, one of those guys that just worked and worked and worked every day and then finally got that scholarship.
Third down from midfield. The pass broken up, intended for Rhodes. And when he was hit by Whitney, he could not hold on.
That's two good plays, or coverage plays by Rich Whitney. Third. A bunch of Roman numerals after his name. Number 45, just kind of fighting through some traffic, makes a nice hit on the receiver. Guys with Roman numerals will play defense. Have you noticed that after the name?
It's true. You make a good point. Fourth down try. And they convert. Nicely done. The pass caught by Bruce Williams as Perry Patterson converts with a fourth down pass for 12 yards.
Bruce Williams, you know, there's some positive for Greg Robinson, his guys, young guys like Bruce Williams, a freshman out of Christian Brothers High School right there in Syracuse, New York.
And made, he was a late addition to the recruiting class and a valuable one. Wide receiver and free safety at Christian Brothers. 216 career receptions, 51 touchdowns.
You should catch a lot of those from Greg Paulus, quarterback there, who's now playing point guard for Duke.
Play. They tried to pitch it. It's fumbled. A free ball. And Syracuse was able to fall in. Casey Cullen was there scrambling and made the play. And nearly a turnover. But Damian Rhodes able to retain possession for the Orange.
Real good play by number 60. Casey Cullen just nailing the quarterback. His great-grandfather, Fleet-footed Flanagan, would be very happy with that one, wouldn't he, Tom?
Didn't have to be too fleet to make that one, but you were 240 pounds.
But, you know, if you were, you know, running a big company, wouldn't you want to hire some of these walk-ons, not just at Notre Dame? These guys work anywhere, at Syracuse, at Notre Dame. These guys work hard, just as hard as the starters every single week to prepare the team to play.
Without any of the glory.
Yeah.
Flag down on that play, and Whitney could be called for interference on Bruce Williams.
I just think, you know, the walk-ons, and I played with them years and years ago, you always had a special place in your heart. And I think particularly the front-line players, the stars, have a...
Pass interference, number 45 on the defense. Ball be placed at the spot of the foul. First down.
Have a special place in their heart for guys like Whitney, number 45 there, who, as I said, come out every single day and get beaten up and yelled at and giving the team the look. You know, the look that you're going to face that next week. But Charlie Weiss did a nice thing. Has a, you know, what he calls the scout team MVP.
Maybe you should make a movie about that.
It's already been done. It's the remake. You mean Rich Whitney III.
Damian Rhodes brings to the outside. And Rhodes at the sideline. Carney with an angle knocked him out of bounds. So Notre Dame trying to rack up victory number 8 on the season against their two losses and keep alive their drive for a BCS bowl. They'll finish up on the road at Stanford next week. Facing a tough Syracuse defense, the Irish were slow starting today. At the end of a first quarter, Syracuse led 3-0. The Irish scored twice, two touchdowns in the second quarter to take command of the game and have never looked back. But it has been hard to come by against a Syracuse defense that's been awfully tough, while the Syracuse offense has struggled. Same play.
Jim Carney again.
On Rhodes.
From Lexington Catholic High School.
Thank you.
He's a guy that comes a good football family. His dad played in the Air Force. He had an uncle who was a great UCLA receiver.
He is actually one of the players that will graduate but can petition for another year of eligibility from the university.
This is a guy that was highly recruited. Nearly went to Stanford. Was recruited by Michigan, Stanford, Notre Dame, his final three.
Lexington, Kentucky. He's one of 17 players that can be eligible, petitioning for a fifth year of eligibility. Patterson chased, got it away, but Rhodes probably wishes he hadn't.
Nick Chicatano.
Chicatano. Big hit.
Number 25 for the Irish, a guy who came here with high expectations of being a running back. And they switched him to defense, now playing defensive end, number 25, although he dropped off in coverage on that one. Good chase by that inside linebacker blitz, and Chicatano's right there. Syracuse has just not stopped or even slowed down the inside blitz of the Irish, no matter who's doing it, first team, second team.
Third down. Trips to the right. Patterson chased. Got away, ducked out of bounds. Again, Patterson has gone all the way at quarterback. We have not seen Joe Fields, though he was on the field for a play along with Patterson. Joe Boland chased Patterson out that time as Fields watches from the sideline.
You know, and you have to feel a little badly for Joe Fields and Perry Patterson, really kind of caught in a coaching change, different style of offense. Joe Fields is a fine option quarterback, but, you know, he's asked to drop back and throw it. That's just not what Joe does well.
Fourth down try. They converted one earlier on this drive. Touchdown is Joe Kowaleski.
This is Joe.
James Kowaleski with the Syracuse touchdown.
It's his second touchdown catch of the season.
He's caught a pass in 10 consecutive games.
And Patterson throws the touchdown, his fifth.
And the team's sixth of the year. Good, good inside protection that time for Patterson.
How wide open was he?
Very. So this is the guy, Kowaleski, that, you know, always wanted to play at Syracuse, and, you know, good for him. Still battling there late in the game.
Ricky Krautman for the extra point. And it is good.
It is good. Remaining 34, Syracuse.
So the big tight end gets the touchdown reception.
Yeah, Perry Patterson did a good job of avoiding the early part of that play. Could have been sacked. Kowaleski catches it, lumbers it in the end zone, knows exactly where he has to go. Warner's New York. Seven catches against Virginia a few weeks ago.
Patterson was 6 out of 8 on that drive, 53 yards and the touchdown. Let's go to Lewis.
All right, Tom, thanks a lot. We'll have a chance to catch up with Notre Dame Athletic Director Kevin White. And Kevin, I'm wanting an athletic director's point of view on what this season is by the season of redirection with Charlie Weiss at the helm, what he's meant to the team and to the community.
Well, Charlie's brought great leadership to the program, Lewis, and we're really excited about our future. Trend line's awfully positive. Recruiting is really over the top. We think we'll have one of the best classes, if not the best class in the country. And I think it really starts with Charlie. He surrounded himself with a terrific staff. So we couldn't be more excited about the future.
And the future he talked about possibly next year, maybe making a run toward a championship. I know that's got to be something that you think is possible with the way he's done it so far this year.
I tell you what, right now we're trying to make a run towards Palo Alto. We've got a big game next week, and I don't think we're going to look beyond that. But this has been a tough game here this afternoon. This Syracuse team is has played a heck of a football game. Anyway, it's good to have this one just about behind us. But at this point, it's all about Palo Alto.
All right. Thanks so much.
Thanks, Lewis. Thank you.
So.
All right, Lewis. David Grimes returning that kickoff. Coach Weiss would have been proud of his athletic director for keeping the focus on Stanford, not letting the mind wander to other things, Lewis.
Kevin White told me he just became, an Irish citizen, dual citizenship now. But Irish. And look who's just come into the game, number 12.
Marty Mooney. Senior from Cincinnati.
Transferred from Yale. Started at Yale, then played on a Hall team, Morrissey Hall. And now here he is playing with the Irish.
Actually got some playing action at Purdue earlier this year.
He was Marty Mooney in Cincinnati. You mentioned he played football there. It was at Xavier High School, and he actually played against Brady Quinn in high school and beat him in a playoff game.
Yeah, Dublin Kaufman.
So he kind of rubs it into Brady every once in a while, and then Brady says, hey, look at my numbers.
Jeff Jenkins got that last carry as Mooney's back out. Ashley McConnell's also in the game. Marcus Freeman at tight end. Jenkins with another carry as we take a look at our ADT defensive play of the game.
Well, how about the play by Lou Farine? Opening series in the second half. A relatively close game, but that begun the Irish onslaught. And it should be the ADT defensive play of the game. Farine has played very well in the nickel situation and had to play a lot more regularly in the second half.
Brian Mattis in the offensive line for the Irish here on this series. Moody's pass is complete. And did that put a charge in the fans? It's complete to Michael O'Hara. 15 yards. There's O'Hara, number 84.
Nice throw here by Moody, just like a rocket. Perfect spiral on the deep slant by O'Hara. Wow. You know, one of those walk-on guys is O'Hara.
Rob Woods also in at a wide receiver spot. Jenkins. Up to the line of scrimmage. And time to take a look at our Chevrolet players of the game. Damian Rhodes rushed for 112 yards for Syracuse. Brady Quinn, I don't think he really had his best day. Some of his throws were not on target. But then I don't get a vote.
Still pretty productive.
270 yards and two touchdowns despite that fact. And there's Rhodes, who gained over 100 on the Irish. In recognition of their determination and outstanding play, Chevrolet will make a $1,000 contribution to each university's general scholarship fund, Chevy and American Revolution.
Jenkins. Tom, you mentioned Rob Woods, number 81 for the Irish, playing wide receiver right now. A guy that earned a scholarship, walked on, earned a scholarship, 3.9 GPA in mechanical engineering. And Charlie Weiss, win number 8.
Joey Heidman also got some time in on that last play. Just want to make sure everybody got recognized playing his final home game. Brandon Hoyt being congratulated by his teammates. As the Irish seniors close out the campaign, Coach Weiss, Coach Robinson, who've known each other for years. Two first-year coaches that have seen their teams perform quite differently. Matt Shelton is 82, his final game. So the Irish keep alive their drive for the BCS behind 100-yard rushing day for Darius Walker. Let's go to Lewis.
Okay, Tom, thanks a lot. Well, Coach, a big day, another big win. But today the theme seemed to be about the seniors. If you could talk to me about this moment in their last game here at Notre Dame Stadium.
Yeah, I think the one thing we want to do is send these seniors out with a win, and I'm just glad that at the end of the game we got a chance to honor the seniors that were playing and then get all those other guys in the game. We feel good that we were able to end the game that way.
All right, Coach Weiss, thanks and good luck next week. Okay, Tom.
All right, Lewis, they will wind up the regular season next week with a game at Stanford. Final score today, 34-10 over the
Pete Giordano hits Marcus Sales for the 39-yard score, and now it's just 28-21 Titans. But Robbie Brown and Webster Thomas answered in the fourth. Thomas. It's Robbie Brown on the scramble, and he breaks through, gets to the corner for the touchdown. Titans advance 34-21.
We've been working so hard all year for the game like this. CBA, they kept fighting every single play. They never gave up. And this win's for Section 5. So we're really happy to have a shot at the state title here.
The Titans are now 12-0 and headed to the state finals next weekend. What about Class C action? Marcus Whitman up against Sydney from Section 4. The Wildcats with the ball late first half, trailing 14-7. Jason Cota hits Adam Heron. That set up a Whitman touchdown. It was 14-14 at the half. Sydney took the lead in the third quarter, but the Wildcats came back. This time, Cota to Nathan Cowles to tie the game at 22 in the fourth. But Sydney drove late in the game. Aaron Zern, 11-yard run, 55 seconds left, and that wins it. Sydney over Whitman, 28-22, the final. Section 5 boys soccer teams in each class for the state semis today in Oneonta. We started off in Class AA. McQuaid going up against unbeaten White Plains from Section 1. It was scoreless in the second tonight. Trevor Packer crossed it off. And Connor Cleary O'Leary's head to Dave Vogt for the goal. McQuaid added another, and they won it 2-0 in the final today. Other action, Mendon in Class A taking on Owego of Section 4. Mendon trailed 1-0, but the Vikings rallied. Chris Bolano to Dan Mitchell, and it was tied. Later, Chris Parker stayed with it and beat the keeper. Mendon won it 2-1 the final today in Class A. So Mendon's headed to the state finals tomorrow. Other boys scores from today. Byron Virgin lost in the Class B semis. Red Creek in Class C beat Maple Hill in overtime. Shazy beat Fillmore in the Class D semis. On the girls' side, it was York losing in the Class C state final, 1-0 to Hoosick Falls in overtime. State finals in field hockey. Class C, East Rochester and Harpersville in Syracuse. ER's Maria Correa takes the shot, and Krista Archambault knocks in the rebound.
Yeah, I think they got all the sponsor beverages covered in that shower, too. Going to get the victory hug. You ready? What was that? Did you just say it again?
Thank God it's over. Man, we could not do anything right for the past 2 months, and I'm just glad it's over. This is awesome.
Martin, tell me.
Crowd, you couldn't believe it. And then I went to Blue Max with Raymond Beadle and Barry Dotson and Harold Elliott and that gang, and boy, that's the year that woke me up.
The fourth corner, Rusty Wallace wins the Valleydale 500 and his first Winston Cup race ever.
Well, definitely the greatest moment of my career was my championship in 1989. It was a crowning moment of achievement.
He has won the Winston Cup for 1989 and ending up 12 points ahead of Dale Earnhardt.
My greatest rivalry and one of my greatest friends are the same thing. Dale Earnhardt for sure. Earnhardt and I were always banging each other, always causing controversy, and you would think that we hated each other, you know. And then when the race was over, hey, dude, I'll see you over the house.
Dale Earnhardt has driven down to the scene of Rusty Wallace's accident.
Call it a rivalry or best friendship or what, that fella right there is definitely a guy. I just want to be labeled as a guy that's been one of the most respected drivers out there amongst his peers.
If the car does not handle, it's not going to fix itself. Make a pit stop and work on it. So use your damn heads, please.
You know, being labeled as Rusty the Short Track King, that's a pretty good label, too.
Wallace heads for the checkered flag, becoming the 10th driver to win 50 NASCAR Winston Cup races or more.
And all I want to do is leave this sport with a positive image with all my race fans and the media and my peers. I love racing. That's my core business. That's what I understand. And I feel like I'm pretty good at it. So I'll miss it, but it's going to take a little bit of adjustment for me to calm down.
In his career, 55 wins, 25 on a short track. Rusty Wallace going into Sunday, over $43 million earned. Well, going into Sunday, it'll come down to Stewart, Johnson, Edwards, and Biffle. Carl Edwards starts out in front.
This Ford 400 report, brought to you by Sprint. The chase for the Nextel Cup is on. Sprint, proud partner of the NASCAR Nextel Cup Series.
Seems like there were 400 sporting events on Saturday. Well, we've narrowed it all down to the 10 best plays of the day. So you know you can't miss it. Stick with sports.
All right. Give me Dopey.
All right. I'll take Sleepy.
I'm going to take Doc. No. I meant Doc.
Join us in March for ESPN The Weekend at the Walt Disney World Resort. Visit ESPNTheWeekend.com today.
Hello. Hello, I'm Johnny Cash.
We're all going to hell for the songs we're singing.
Some guys come into the sport, and they can, and in some way, shape, or form, for whatever reason, they become leaders. I think my father had that quality. I think Dale Sr. had that quality. And I think Rusty has that quality now. When you walk around the garage area, Rusty's the guy.
If I traded it all, if I gave it all away for one thing, wouldn't that be something? If I traded it all, if I gave it all.
Back here at the driver's introduction stage, there's been a little trend started. Michael Waltrip started a minute ago, and now his compadres are lining up, having Rusty Wallace sign the driving uniform they'll wear on the day of Rusty's last call. A lot of congratulations all around for Rusty Wallace. While you sign Jamie McMurray's, Rusty, the day is here. Your thoughts?
My thoughts are, I can't believe the day's already came. I mean, I remember a year and a half ago when I announced this tour, and now it's already here. It's just amazing. But one more race. I'm going to give it my best. I feel like I'm going to have a good car today. I want to go out in style.
When you finish signing his, I'll get you to sign mine, too. Rusty Wallace, hoping to finish strong today. He'll have to come from the back. He starts 37th.
Thanks a lot, Alan. Jeremy Mayfield is 10th in points and starts 13th. Casey Mears is still chasing his first win, starts 6th. And Joe Nemechek finished 8th here last year. The Army starts 10th today. Next, a few laps with Wally and some of our favorite memories from his world in 2005.